Ladies and gentlemen, we're live on this Wednesday, the 17th day of August, 2016 Global Edition. We are going to be having several very informative surprise guests in studio today. I'm just going to leave it at that until the next segment. We have a big shakeup at the Trump campaign with the head of Breitbart being brought in to head things up. A really good move. Mr. Bannon is there. And Hillary, House Republicans pursue perjury charges against Hillary. This is her Nixonian moment. But first, an extremely powerful Paul Revere report from John Brown.
Yet another American community is descended on by violent ignorance masquerading as a civil rights protest after a black career criminal was taken out by a black police officer after dangerously brandishing a stolen firearm. So where are the leaders of the supposed righteous anger boiling over in Milwaukee? Typically, President Barack Obama fiddled on the golf course while Rome burned. Obama's deputy press secretary, Jen Friedman, provided a statement that read, "The president is golfing at Farm Neck Golf Club, one of his favorite courses on Martha's Vineyard." Also today, the administration said the president had been updated on the situation in Milwaukee. Meanwhile, Obama protege and Soros-insulated leader of Black Lives Matter, DeRay McKesson, tweeted, "I denounce the state violence that led to any protests in the first place." Is this statement a result of McKesson's shallow incomprehension in the face of total anarchy based on the real facts? Or is there another hand at play here, directing Obama's incompetence and McKesson's callowness? It should come as no surprise that Black Lives Matter leader DeRay McKesson lives in a home owned by philanthropists James and Robin Wood in Baltimore, Maryland. The American Mirror reports it's the same address he used when declaring his residency on his campaign committee registration form for his failed mayoral run in the city's Democratic primary earlier this year. The Woods have owned the home since 1996 and are wealthy donors to the Baltimore chapter of George Soros's Open Society Institute. Robin is so active that she was made a board member of the far-left nonprofit back in 2008, according to the OSI's website. Anarchy organizer McKesson essentially resides in a clear example of the supposed white suburbs that the deranged mob in Milwaukee is threatening to burn down. And while the pawns of George Soros do their part to subtly fan the flames of division amongst the brainwashed citizens of the United States, led by a wave of the Chicago chapter of the Revolutionary Communist Party, now being largely blamed for the escalation in Milwaukee, George Soros and sons continue to build a Trojan horse of jihadist migration-embedded refugees aimed squarely at nothing less than unleashing a total disintegration of Western civilization. The Daily Caller reports a leaked memo from left-wing financier George Soros's Open Society Foundations argues that Europe's refugee crisis should be accepted as a new normal, and that the refugee crisis means new opportunities for Soros's organization to influence immigration policies on a global scale. A section of the review titled Our Work describes how America's least transparent think tank has worked with leaders in the field to shape migration policymaking and influence regional and global processes affecting the way migration is governed and enforced. In a section titled Our Ambitions, the authors explain, "Our premise for engaging in work related to governance was that, in addition to mitigating the negative effects of enforcement, we should also be supporting actors in the field proactively seeking to change the policies, rules, and regulations that govern migration. Anarchy at our doorstep, fueled by foreign interests, lingering hubris in the White House, and a treasonous, power-hungry menace is one step away from being the next commander-in-chief. Time to wake up, America, before you wake up homeless on the continent your fathers conquered."
You still don't get it, do you, boys? There ain't no countries anymore. No more good guys. They're running the whole show. They own everything, the whole damn planet. They can do whatever they want. What's wrong with having it good for a change? Now, they're going to let us have it good if we just help them. They're going to leave us alone. Let us make some money. You can have a little taste of that good life, too.
John Bell for Infowars.com.
Stay with us. A lot of good news, a lot of positive things happening. House Republicans pursue perjury charges against Hillary Clinton, and they've got the votes to move forward with it if they have the courage. This is a big, big deal. We're going to be playing several minute clip from those hearings and from those announcements coming up here in just a few minutes. We also have Obamacare in big trouble nationally as insurers tire of losing money. That's the select insurance companies that aren't the insiders, though, that wrote the bill. We also have, obviously, massive news dealing with the Trump campaign, with the chairman and head of Breitbart, Stephen Bannon, who is a patriot and who is an anti-globalist, taking over as the CEO chairman of the entire campaign. Paul Manafort, who's also been doing a great job, is going to be staying on in the position he's at right now. This is just an expansion of the campaign, in Bannon's own words and in Manafort's own words. And I talked to Roger Stone. He concurs with that and said that he was also part of the research and, you know, trying to bring the head of Breitbart, who also heads up the institute dealing with government corruption and fighting government corruption. He's the co-founder, executive chairman of Government Accountability Institute and the executive chairman of Breitbart News, LLC. You've noticed since he's been running Breitbart, it's gotten more hardcore, more pro-Second Amendment, not that it was ever bad, and really tells it like it is about the true nature of what's happening, that this is a globalist New World Order takeover program. I mean, we have the emails from the UN. We have the emails from the normal cast of characters like George Soros. We know what's going on. And just because the old mainstream media calls us conspiracy theorists when we cover facts doesn't mean we should then bow down to them. And that's why they're calling him a street fighter, a brawler. The media is scared of this move because Manafort's pretty hardcore, but not compared to Trump. Obviously, you get Stephen Bannon and these other folks that have joined the campaign in there. This is really creating a globalist nightmare. So we're going to be breaking that down. You've got Roger Ailes unofficially, obviously, advising on the debates and a lot more. So you notice InfoWars overall, though, has made it safe to talk about the New World Order, to talk about globalism, to talk about things that people wouldn't even discuss 5 years ago. And Donald Trump has helped widen the acceptance of reality, and so has Matt Drudge, and so have you. So this is a big victory overall, because the New World Order wants to establish this planetary government in the shadows and never have a debate about it. No, we're going to talk about the TPP. We're going to talk about open borders. We're going to talk about executive action by the president outside of law, where they just open the borders up and make us pay for everybody. We're going to discuss our government funding radical orthodox jihadist persecuting Christians worldwide at a rate never before seen. Even the UN admits the persecution of Christians is double what it's ever been seen, and it's our government, criminal elements of it, that are directing this. We are 2 minutes to midnight, as I say every day. So all of this is coming up and more. First off, Obama, as usual, has more and more egg on his face. Stanford University and the Stanford Research Institute, that's the university officially itself, came out with a big study last week dealing with the fact that there was systemic election fraud at the highest levels across the country, stealing the nomination from Bernie Sanders. The Hill newspaper covered this yesterday. On Monday, CBS News ran the headline that there is massive fraud going on across the country, both electoral at the top and retail fraud on the bottom. The Democratic Party has put out a talking point that it does not exist. They've even had seminar callers or trained callers calling into talk radio, including the show, and repeating talking points saying, ha, 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 you're crazy. It doesn't exist. Like, ha, 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 you know, the sun doesn't come up in the morning. Ha, 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 ha. Well, next you'll say water is wet. Ha, 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 ha. And then try to laugh at you. It's not working. Now, this is from Reuters, of all places, that likes to put out fake polls, sampling 15% more Democrats than Republicans to put Hillary 15 points ahead. Even Reuters is having to admit this. U.S. offers states help to fight election hacking. I thought there wasn't any such a thing. I thought there weren't HBO documentaries that have congressional testimony where they admit it and where the chief Diebold engineers go public. And I mean, I thought this didn't exist. But, oh, Jay Johnson, he's going to come in and make sure there's no fraud. And what did Roger Stone say when he joined us on Monday about this? He said he'd be concerned about the federal election officials that are going to come in. Because remember, Obama said the feds aren't involved in elections because there's no fraud. In fact, he said, what is election fraud? Boy, has this blown up in his lion face.
Elections will not be rigged. What does that mean? The federal government doesn't run the election process. States and cities and communities all across the country, they're the ones who set up the voting systems and the voting booths. And if Mr. Trump is suggesting that there is a conspiracy theory that is being propagated across the country, including in places like Texas, where typically it's not Democrats who are in charge of voting booths, that's ridiculous. That doesn't make any sense, and I don't think anybody would take that serious.
Okay, so we're talking about national election fraud in battleground states. So we didn't say we thought the Democrats were going to steal the election in Texas. We said Trump has internal polling that they do scientifically to really see what's happening, where he is at a dead heat in places like California and 7 to 12 points ahead in Florida and 5 to 10 points depending on which poll they do, and other real scientific polls show this than is in the news, that, you know, he's 5 to 10 points ahead in places like Ohio. It varies. The point is, when you see the news saying Hillary's got a 10, 15, or 22-point lead, you better believe that is a load of horse pucky. But just think about that clip. The feds aren't involved in elections. Not true. They let the media, six secretive groups, announce it. Formerly Voter News Services. Now it's the Election Pool Services. And then Edison Services. I mean, every few months they're changing the name now. And that's the group that announced California for Bernie Sanders the day before in a meeting they had, according to the Associated Press. It reported on itself. The AP runs it. And then they go, oh, we're calling it for Sanders because the superdelegates are going to go for Hillary. We're calling it against Sanders. So you have Obama saying the feds aren't involved, but now they are involved, to come in and make sure hacks don't happen. Oh, they're going to have their little computer technicians, their little specialists hooked up to our local voting machines to make sure everything's running okay. That's never happened before. When you've seen manipulated elections, the feds will meet in shadowy mansions with the major donors and superdelegates, and then they'll try to call it for somebody else before the polls close, and then there'll be a whole election fight over it. That's how this situation has been in the past. But this is now blowing up in Obama's face because he is saying that the feds aren't involved in the election process, but now here they are saying they are going to be involved in it. And that's been our big fear, quite frankly, behind the scenes, was that if you heard that they were going to send the feds in to administer the elections and to hook into the computers, the Justice Department, the same ones that are no-billing Hillary Clinton, the same ones that are letting us be sold out to the communist Chinese, the same ones that illegally ignore the Supreme Court and the law and advertise for the illegal aliens to come here and be loaded on buses and then shipped into the United States to be signed up as Democratic Party clients. The same ones that are going after the Second Amendment extrajudicially, extra-legislatively, outside of law. The same ones that are engaged in all these different types of criminal activities. The same Justice Department that allows hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars a year, billions in total, to flood the Clinton Foundation. And we even have the emails where they give them money and say, now get me a meeting with this person from the State Department on Z or A issue. Amazing. So now the corrupt Justice Department, legendarily corrupt, nakedly corrupt, brazenly corrupt, dripping with chutzpah, dripping with bravado, dripping with arrogance. U.S. offers states, the U.S. is the states. We are the United States. Everything's a lie now from mainstream media. Everything's a psychological warfare event. U.S. offers states help to fight election hacking. But the president says, what is election fraud? It doesn't exist. But if you're so worried about it, Texas, you're running things. Why are you saying we're going to steal it in Texas as if it's not a national election? And I'll tell you why they're panicking when we come back. Political science professor who's never been wrong in the last six major elections. Trump has an 87% chance of winning the election. We've got the video of that. Remember this, app maker, Trump will win election. USA Today, they're tracking hundreds of thousands of people, what they're really planning to do. Gateway pundit, social media partners show Trump is looking at a landslide victory. Absolutely, just off traffic in past elections, they know. That's why the Justice Department, the Injustice Department, the George Soros Department is going to come in and hook up machines to your voting machines and make sure everything's okay. Paul Manafort is no longer the overall head of the Trump campaign. It is now Stephen Bannon. And that guy is even more vicious than Trump when it comes to going up against the New World Order. This is really, I think, good news overall. And again, it's just an expansion of the campaign because Trump, in the last 83 days, 82 days now, until the election, is putting brass knuckles on. He took the gloves off about a month ago. Brass knuckles are now going on. And you're going to see spectacular events. He is going to savage the living daylights out of Hillary Clinton during the debates. In fact, I think she'll probably have a seizure. I'm serious, right there on the spot. She can't even handle someone questioning her. She's so psychotic. You question her, she blows up. She can't handle anything. And by the way, I've been covering the Clintons for 21 years. I've probably interviewed more Clinton insiders than anybody. And I mean, I'm telling you, we're not putting hype out there against Hillary. She is bad news. Political science professor, Trump has an 87% chance of winning the election. He has never been wrong about one of these elections. He's also applied the algorithm back to elections earlier in the last century and found it's very, very accurate. Political science professor Helmut Northpol, whose election model has accurately predicted the outcome of the popular vote five times in a row, asserts that Donald Trump has an 87% chance of winning. By the way, he's nonpartisan, the presidency. Appearing on Fox Business with Lou Dobbs. You think this should be on Fox, CNN, but no, they don't want you to know this. Norpeth said the forecast confounded the poll numbers. Let's go ahead and play that interview or a clip from that interview. The story is on Infowars.com. We need to get it out to everyone you know. It's a Paul Joseph Watson article. It's got other polls and other numbers showing why we think Trump is going to win. USA Today, app maker, Trump will win election. That's what the real numbers. Polls are so old-fashioned, folks. Who's got landlines? Everybody knows this. They target certain demographics, certain phone numbers, where they know the response they're going to get on average. It's staged. There's real internal polling that's very accurate. But then there's the baloney polls that create the perception Trump's losing. And it's having an effect to a certain extent. It's gotten weak-minded people to buy into it. But let's get to that clip.
Joining me now, Helmut Norpoth, political science professor at Stony Brook University in New York. Professor, good to have you back with us. I just want to tell everybody, back in March, the professor projected, his model projected, an 87% chance that Donald Trump would win the election. What does your model suggest now?
The same thing.
Still 87% chance of winning?
Yes.
Despite all of the naysayers and the negative noise that we see in the national media, unrelenting attacks on Donald Trump from every quarter. Still 87%.
That's what the model says, and I know that right. If you look at polls right now, that's not what polls are saying. Mm-hmm. But polls are about what how people feel today.
Yeah.
And the election is not on for another 2 months.
People are asking themselves right now, just how accurate is Professor Norpoth's model? How accurate has it been in elections over time?
Well, I started this in 1996, did the first forecast in that year. Then I've done it for the last five presidential election years. Mm-hmm. And the model has predicted the winner of the popular vote correctly each time.
Each time. That's extraordinary. And of course, with the exception of 2000, I don't know how you judge that. Some people say that he, how do you evaluate that 1 year?
Well, it's a tricky one. But
for all of us.
Well, that's why I said predicted the popular vote. So the model predicts the popular vote in that election year. It does not predict that George Bush would end up being president.
Yeah, I think it's pretty likely this year, based on the way things are set up. With the advantage, really, to the Democrats electorally, that the winner of the popular vote will likely be the winner. So you still, you're still confident in your poll.
Well, it takes a lot. It takes a very close election for this to happen, that there's a mismatch. So something like 50,
there you
50,
go, 50, ladies and gentlemen. A lot of folks wonder why some of these videos we grab off YouTube are shot off of television. That's because it beats the bots. There's these bots out there claiming, you know, copyright on stuff, and that's how folks do that, is they'll shoot video right off a computer screen, and that beats the bots. You know how we beat the bots? It's fair use. We're showing a small clip, giving attribution, and then giving our political analysis and cultural analysis of it. And I've researched this poll going back several elections. This guy just gets more and more accurate each time he is proven correct, and that's what the social media mass numbers are showing. That's what all the real app numbers are showing, where they've got real back-end stuff on what people are really clicking, what they're really doing, real decisions they're making. That's how Amazon can predict what you're going to order days before you order it. Remember that? So, see, they know Trump's really ahead. That's why they're panicking so much and getting ready to try to steal it. All right, this story went up yesterday on Infowars.com. And to their credit, Drudge had a link, I think, to a Breitbart story on the same topic, and WorldNet Daily covered it in Daily Caller. That was basically about it. And again, it's a scary thought when the House is moving to have perjury charges on Hillary. She's clearly been caught lying. The FBI is being blackmailed or Lord knows what, won't take action on admitted crime. Bill Clinton, in fact, we played this clip on Sunday, but can you guys cue it up? I want to play that first, where Bill Clinton says the FBI director's statement is full of bull. Hillary has been caught red-handed. The FBI director had to admit she'd been caught red-handed, but that he couldn't get prosecutors to go after her because of the way the case had been handled. Okay, whatever. You got Bill Clinton running on airplanes, meeting with the attorney general. Totally illegal. The attorney general should step down immediately. And this arrogant creature is now shooting his mouth off. We're going to get to this in a moment. I'm going to have Don Salazar's article reposted to the front of Infowars.com. And I'm going to ask the Nightly News to cover this, and I'm going to hammer this all week long. If we get real hearings going and they move forward with perjury charges against her, this will bring her down. And people say, oh, well, it's an election. Don't try to foil it by sending her to jail. That'd be like saying if she was drunk driving and ran over a little kid in front of 20 people, and then she doesn't get charged because she's running for president. She has to be charged. And if the grand juries and the FBI and everybody else are too scared to do it, then Congress needs to do it, and right now. And that's why I wanted to get Bob Barr, because he's the guy that moved forward. Say what you want about Bob Barr. He wasn't even Tea Party enough for the Tea Party. Bob Barr wasn't perfect. But when it came to the Second Amendment and going after criminals and going after Chinese spies and stuff, he's awesome. And he got cheated in Georgia, no doubt, the way they've gerrymandered that and the way that the Republican establishment tricked the Tea Party to go after him. And I'm not against who won. It's just very frustrating, because if you had a Bob Barr, he would be moving forward this right now, and it would happen. But we are very, 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 very close right now. So I'm going to get to that in a moment. First off, I am doing a living defense cleanse right now from the smallest parasites up to the largest. It has dozens and dozens and dozens of ancient, known, from the wives' tales to, you know, to science, herbs and plant extracts that are known to knock out parasites. That's why one of the chief ones is wormwood. Concentrated organic, wildcrafted black walnut, green hull. You know, the Native Americans would take green hull black walnuts and soak them in water once a year, and everybody would drink it because the medicine man said, get rid of the worms. I mean, it's known. This is the way to do it. Organic wormwood, clove bud. It just goes on and on. I'm not going to mention the, it's got to be 30-something ingredients in here. The reason this sells out for months and months, once for 6 months, is trying to source all of this and have each ingredient tested and try to have it at California standards, which everybody's heard about, are so high, almost no one can pass it. That's why a lot of times you hear supplement ads and they say, not available in California. Because the lawyers got laws passed there where there's more lead in the air than you can have in supplements in California. And it is so hard to find batches of things that are that clean. So that's why some of these products we have, like DNA Force or products like Living Defense, harmful organic cleansing, harmful organism cleansing dietary supplement, that's why it's so hard to keep these in stock. It will sell out by the end of the week. The good news is we should get more in by the end of the month. We're getting better on our supply pipeline. And it's your purchases of these products that makes this whole show possible. But I'm telling you, for my overall health, it's amazing. For my children, you name it. Dr. Group says you should probably do a cleanse twice a year. So you're talking about a bottle once a year for each person in your family. And it smells so good. It's got these amazing concentrated herbs in it. And it's just the energy, the stamina. It's not just that it's bad for the harmful organisms. It just does so much for you when you don't have, and most people have them, harmful organisms in your gut that are putting out toxins. That's a nice way of putting it. They're using the restroom in your guts. And it's linked to a lot of people's allergies, headaches. The list goes on and on. The point is, deworming yourself is pretty darn important. And I personally go the way of nature. And you've got all these third world populations pouring in, all the stuff that's happening. The least the Border Patrol should do when they let folks in that have all these different parasites and diseases would be give them something like this. But that product is now available at InfoWarsLife.com or by simply calling toll-free 888-253-3139. Now, before I go any further, we also have the Hillary for Prison shirts. We also have the Bill Clinton rape shirts. We also have a lot of other great nutraceuticals and supplements available at InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. Is the subsection for the nutraceuticals. We have the great Molon Labe shirts, and we have several new designs of those as well. We have the new Molon Labe Texas design that is just an amazing shirt. The fabric feels so good. It's all from America. The fabric, it's sewn in America. It's printed in America. And it's really hard to find a designer shirt like this for lower than $35 to $40. That's why at $22, it is such a steal. Three different designs of the Come and Take It / Molon Labe shirts. On the back, it has the Don't Tread on Me snake and InfoWars.com to help spread the word. Now, just a final caveat on the T-shirts. You witnessed what happened at the RNC with an ocean of folks wearing Hillary for Prison shirts. That shook the system up. And all over the country, people are meeting like-minded people. It is showing your solidarity with liberty, and it's showing everybody how powerful InfoWars is because of the tens of millions of listeners we have. When tens of thousands of you go out at public events and at Hillary events or at Trump events, you are showing that this information really is the popular, dominant, truthful, political cosmology of the Republic. And all we're doing is going back and restoring common sense values that made this nation the apple of the world's eye. The globalists can criticize America and cherry-pick bad examples of things that happened here, and Lord knows they did. But no one can deny the fact that everybody wanted to come here, and we were the most inventive, the most hardworking, the most diverse culturally, and that we were something special. But the New World Order can't compete with the American system, so it wants to bring it down while it uses the blood, sweat, and tears and ingenuity and smarts and toughness of this republic, what's left of it, to build its planetary corporate world government. And we're saying no. And the talking point that Americanism, not globalism, will be our credo, our maxim, comes from InfoWars. I have taken classic Americana, paleoconservative, classical liberal, Renaissance, 1776 ideas, and simply put them out in a no-holds-barred, street fighter, brass-knuckled presentation. Because that's what it is. Soros has been caught in his own emails. Hell, he's proud of it, though. Financing the jihadi invasion and financing groups to go out in the media and target folks that are exposing the jihad invasion. He's the one getting laws passed in Europe and bragging about it to arrest people. He's the one working with Zuckerberg and Hillary and Obama to go after the free speech. This guy's a tyrant. And the answer to that is to get hardcore with these people and take the gloves off. Put the brass knuckles on, because they're taking a hatchet to us. Yes, it's extreme to say George Soros is a globalist criminal trying to overthrow the country. He admits it. He does it to countless other nations. And by countless, because it's ongoing in a whole bunch of countries right now. He's trying to overthrow, admittedly, more than 10 countries and bragging about it right now. He just runs around overthrowing everything. He's a Rothschild front man. It's all funny to these people. It's not funny to me. And I'm not going to see the Republic overthrown, our guns taken, families broken up, the tax situation set up where families are basically made obsolete, with weaponized gangster culture media being spewed at everyone. All I'm doing is fighting back for my life. I understand our way of life and common sense and decency is under attack, and I'm not rolling over for it. What about you? Let me get to the really good news now that I started to mention. We now see Obama coming out in the last few weeks and saying, election fraud, what's that? But then a Stanford Research Institute comes out and says election fraud is massive. You stole the election from Bernie Sanders, Hillary. As CBS News comes out this week and says, yes, election fraud is just absolutely massive, a huge problem, CBS News. As we have former CBS reporter Cheryl Atkinson coming out and looking at all these big national polls, and she's putting out investigative reports proving their frauds. We have the Justice Department now that's not supposedly involved in elections saying they're going to be coming and monitoring the elections and monitoring the computers and, of course, hooking up to them in key battleground states to make sure everything runs right. Talk about a fox in the henhouse. And that's exactly what Roger Stone said on Monday. We got to get Stone on about this today or tomorrow. He said, I would be watching for the federal watchers who they deny are going to be there. Well, now they're going to be there. The same ones that made sure with the mainstream media to announce Bernie Sanders lost. Now, let's move to the big enchilada. They're panicking because, as I mentioned earlier, political science professor who's never been wrong with his algorithm in the last six elections, Trump has 87% chance of winning the election. This is USA Today. App maker, Trump will win election because they actually see who is in there by the hundreds of thousands of users a day and what they're clicking on and what they're supporting, and it's Trump, and they have the demographics to know. Just like Amazon, with over a billion customers, ladies and gentlemen, 2 years ago said, we can already, with customers that are on our site every day, with our advantage customers, we can predict with a 99%+ accuracy what you're going to buy days or hours before you buy it. So we already have it packaged and waiting for you when you order it. Remember that? Type that in. If you don't believe me, you're a new listener, because it sounds unbelievable. Amazon has your order ready before you order it and knows what you're going to order. Now, if they know that, they really know who is ahead. The whole system is against Trump because they know he's a populist. They're scared of him. They don't control him. And that ties into social media patterns show Trump is looking at a landslide victory. Again, those are just some of the articles the last few days. There's the Wall Street Journal. Amazon wants to ship your package before you buy it. And then they go into the fact that they can already do it. Again, 2 years ago. Boom. See, I have a memory. All of you could have a memory this good, but they train us not to have one. People hear me just spew all this info. They go, oh, that guy's making that up. How could he know all that and just spew it out? Because I live this. This is what I do. And Trump is smart to get the head of Breitbart to be his chief advisor now, because this is a street war. This is an internet war. Trump knows where to get advice, and I'm going to leave it right there. Okay, let's continue here to the big enchilada. Now, this is getting almost no attention. I want it red linked back to the front page of InfoWars.com. It went up yesterday. House Republicans pursue perjury charges against Hillary. Congressman pressed DOJ to act on evidence showing Hillary willfully lied during sworn testimony. Adan Salazar wrote the article. Members of the House Oversight Committee and Judiciary Committee are pointing out evidence taken directly from sworn testimony, which may lead to perjury charges against Democrat presidential candidate Hillary Clinton. Republican Jason Chevitz and Judiciary Committee Chairman Bob Goodlatte, if I pronounced that right, penned a letter to U.S. Attorney for the District of Columbia presenting key evidence of information showing Clinton willfully lied during the October 22, 2015 interrogation regarding the Benghazi debacle, in which she also answered questions concerning her illegal private email server. So now we've got the House of Representatives so desperate, it's having to put out little three-minute blurbs showing where she lied. I mean, she used to say she didn't have private email. Remember, the head of the EPA had to step down because she got caught doing that. They do this to get around FOIA and Freedom of Information Act. They do this to keep stuff secret. They do this to commit crimes. That's why it's a crime, what she did. Just to have it separately is a crime. Then she would order them to cut the classified part off the top. Just altering a secret document is a felony. And then she lies to Congress and says she never sent or received secret documents, even though we have her ordering them to do so. And there's 30-something thousand of them missing. Lying, 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 lying. And now we have the Republicans, the Judiciary Committee chairman, and others penning a letter to the U.S. Attorney for the District of Columbia presenting key pieces of information showing Clinton willfully lied during the October 22, 2015 investigation and interrogation. And they need to move forward with congressional hearings on the perjury. A representative for the Justice Department responded to the request August 2nd. This has been going on for weeks, saying they would take appropriate action as necessary. However, no timeline was offered. As they run the clock, you can't. It's Loretta Lynch. An accompanying video asked, where's Hillary Clinton's statement false? Were also recently uploaded to the Committee on Oversight and Government Reform. We just played it from YouTube, comparing Clinton's testimony with statements FBI Director James Comey made. Well, forget what Comey said. He's telling the truth there. It's what is admitted in the emails and the fact that she changed her story over and over again. In their letter, the congressman pointed out Clinton misled Congress when she said she had not handled classified information. Secretary Clinton stated there was nothing marked classified on the emails, either sent or received. The letter to the U.S. attorney reads, but Clinton's comments are contrasts of FBI directors Comey's July 5th announcement, in which he said a very small number of the emails contained classified information and they bore the markings. They got lazy, indicating the presence of classified information. So the question is, where does this go? Retired Assistant FBI Director Stephen Pomerantz said a decision to pursue perjury charges, given the weight of the evidence, should take mere weeks. Yes, it's open and shut. You testify in court that you didn't steal your neighbor's red pickup truck on said day and that you were somewhere else, that you were, say, fishing in another county. He has surveillance footage, the court then is shown, of you stealing the red pickup. You don't just get convicted of Grand Theft Auto. You get convicted of perjury. Open and shut. Open and shut. The question is, will they now take action and do something about this? House Republicans pursue perjury charges against Clinton. They're not just trying to subpoena her again. They're not just calling it perjury. They have written letters weeks ago. We're just now learning about this, saying we want perjury charges. We have her open and shut. And senior FBI agents are coming out saying, yes, that is exactly what you have here. Open and shut perjury. Open and shut. Cut and dry. Caught red-handed. Meanwhile, though, Bill Clinton thinks it's all funny. Oh, you think it's illegal for me to go meet while I'm under criminal investigation for the foundation and for the emails? My wife is. You think it's improper for me to go get on her airplane to meet with her for, what is it, 45 minutes or whatever? We just talked about sports. Then the next week, the FBI director came out and looked like he saw a ghost and said we'd done a lot of bad stuff, but nobody would stand up against us. Well, you know what I have to say about him. Here's what I have to say about the FBI director.
First of all, with the FBI director, first of all, the FBI director said, when he testified before Congress, he had to amend his previous day statement that she had never received any emails marked classified. They saw two little notes with a C on it. This is the biggest load of bull I ever heard, that were about telephone calls that she needed to make. And the State Department typically puts a little C on it to discourage people from discussing it in public in the event the Secretary of State, whoever it is, doesn't make a telephone call. Does that sound threatening to the national security to you?
I did not have sex. I did not have sex with that woman. Now, we did let Laura Allen Hughes transfer all of our ICBM technology to China in the mid-90s. We got paid handsomely for that. And does that sound bad for the national security? We have her ordering them in the emails. Imagine what she deleted, the 33,000. Ordering them to cut classified off the top of the document. And then he's at this church talking to his idiot followers. Talk about victims. Sitting there, his prey, perched up there like some evil bird, telling them that she didn't ever do anything to nobody. She never hurt anybody. She never did anything to national security, getting hundreds of millions from Gulf states, selling us out, $35 million to give the Russians one-fifth of our uranium. She never did nothing against the national security. You know who did? Donald Trump. That's right. Donald Trump. He's a bad man. And it goes on and on and on. Well, Stephen Bannon, the head of Breitbart, is now the head of the Trump campaign, and that means, as I said earlier, the brass knuckles are going on, and they are going to go all out. He's calling her a criminal, a racketeer, a foreign agent. I just love his tweets now. It is hardcore with 82 days to go. Get ready, baby. 82 days to go, and it is going to get hardcore. And now they've got something I want to cover when we come back. I thought about pulling a stunt just to show Michael Moore what it's like, but I'm not going to do it. You know, announce something like, you know, Michael Moore, you know, is really a Republican and you know, admits blah, blah, blah or something, but I'm not going to do that. There's this talking point from last month that Trump's going to drop out and Trump's fake and Trump wants to do all these things. And Michael Moore has come out in an alternate article that's been put all over the news and said that, well, he's not going to say he has witnesses, but he does, that this is all fake so that Trump will get another TV job, as if Trump needs that, as if Trump's lost a bunch of TV jobs and a bunch of stuff over this, hundreds of millions. It's just a total crap out of the mouth of that demonic creature that is Michael Moore, who has six bodyguards, but you can't have a gun. Well, it's a big deal, but you won't hear it on the news. It's up on Infowars.com. House Republicans pursue perjury charges against Hillary. Congressman pressed DOJ to act on evidence showing Hillary willfully lied during sworn testimony. And Bill Clinton comes out and says it's not true. There was nothing marked classified, so she didn't engage in perjury. She engaged in perjury because she ordered them to remove the classified headings. That and all of it is a crime. Breitbart's S.K. Bannon appointed CEO and Trump campaign shakeup. That's what AP calls it. That's who really wants to try to call the election. The truth is it's an expansion of the campaign. And there's no bad blood. I have confirmed that. They're just bringing on more people that are super media savvy. And this new lady they've brought in has already been working on the campaign. And it seems that she is able to keep Trump, for whatever reason he likes her, on message. So that's what's going on. And he also has known Trump for a long, long time. There's another article out here. How Bloomberg spun its own poll data to make Hillary Clinton seem inevitable. We've got so much that I'm going to be going over here today. He's going to be in studio next week. I got my wires crossed. Steve Quayle, who I want to get on more and more for commentary, is going to be on the phone with us for an hour. Then we're going to have reporters pop in who are still up in Wisconsin. They covered the Trump rally. They covered some of the riots and burning and death that went on up there with the whole Justice Department run operation. And Paul Watson will be hosting the fourth hour with some big guests as well from London, England. I want to get to the Michael Moore situation just briefly when we come back, and then we'll go to Steve Quayle because I don't have time in this segment. But it goes to the deception. When you're looking at the news from 6 in the morning until midnight, when you're constantly checking the latest news feeds, you see the patterns. Anybody can who just barely pays attention. They keep saying his candidacy isn't real. They keep saying he's a fraud. They keep saying Donald Trump is really a Democrat. Donald Trump just wanted to get a better TV deal. And we see this over and over again. Donald Trump is completely for real, and Donald Trump knows his name, his treasure, his credibility is all on the line. It's been estimated, even by CNN, he's lost $200 million from boycotts and losing TV deals and losing his beauty pageants and all of it. Trump decided to really go with his instincts that he's had for 30 years against globalism. And Trump is friends with people like Bannon, who at Breitbart is you know, fighting the New World Order now and joining Drudge and myself and others in reality. So believe me, Trump is a ultra-historic figure here. And the reason they're attacking his credibility and saying he's not real, saying that he's lying to everyone, is because they're the fakes, the globalists are. Let me tell you, Donald Trump's for real, folks. Donald Trump's for real. And I don't say this to brag, because the media already knows this, I can say it. I can have a conversation with Donald Trump and then get information to him, and a day later, he's on the podium talking about election fraud, how they're trying to steal it. And now you got Stanford Research Institute. You've got all these big think tanks. You've got leftist professors saying, yes, they do steal elections. Yes, they're trying to steal it. They've got all these fake polls out, and they've got this unified fraud now. Notice, in fact, cue this up if we can, from 2 weeks ago when he was on Bill Maher, and he told the truth to it, you know, to his minions, the super leftists. He said, no, Trump's ahead. Trump's going to win. I'm out there across the country with blue-collar folks. He's going to win. We better do something. Just to show his duplicitousness, now he comes out and says, Trump's completely fake. I talked to him. Yeah, yeah. He told me so. You lying sack of evil. You are unbelievable. It's just like when I was on BBC once on this big morning show, and I walk off and they go, he said during the break it's all fake. And luckily, I'd been rolling video and it could prove that it wasn't true. I even had video of me confronting the Bilderberg Group member. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central, we're here live. Paul Watson takes over in the fourth hour from London, England. We've got Jacari Jackson, Rob Dew, and the rest of our crew still in Milwaukee, the site of civil unrest the last three, four nights. They also covered a Trump event there last night, where social justice warriors were flipping out. That video is on Infowars.com. We'll be talking to them coming up at the bottom of the next hour. And Gary Haven, as well as Steve Quayle, are going to be in studio with us next Monday in studio. And I'm going to have a film crew with them this weekend as they go around Texas, basically marshaling the troops, warning the people about what's happening, just to give the TV viewers and listeners a microcosm of what other soldiers of liberty are doing now 7 days a week. People like Gary Haven's worth a couple billion dollars, and he is just putting massive amounts of that any way he can to warn the people. And Steve Quayle is working tirelessly, and so many others. And people say, why do you praise Drudge so much? Or why are you praising, you know, Bannon of Breitbart? Because I see how hardcore they're getting, and I see the courage they have. And in a world of cowards, patriots are just larger-than-life heroes. And the globalists hold up basketball players or hockey players as gods, or, you know, Phelps as a god. And I think Phelps is amazing. It's an example of, you know, human determination. He's a, you know, good, clean guy, too. But the point is that that's not who the real role models are for kids. Just 70 years ago, it was inventors, trailblazers, quite frankly, gunfighters. It was the toughest of the tough. It was coal miners. And we have to get back to that. It was the Wright brothers at Kitty Hawk. That's what made us so great. Decadent, corrupt nations, historically, become totally obsessed with sports and gambling and mock gambling and mock sports, simulation, fantasy football. The next level with video games and virtual reality and all the rest of it. And then it goes from there into sexual perversion. And then it goes into sexual identity falling apart. This is a cycle that professors have talked about for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. Camille Paglia has popularized it in some books she's written about it that are historical and very accurate that I read back when I was a teenager. But the point is it's there. And we are in the middle of the swing into the most decadent, dangerous time this planet's ever seen. Because here's the sad part. It's one thing if the Germans are running around, you know, as transsexuals in the 1920s, and then you get Hitler. It's the war that comes out of it. You see, next comes the collapse, the poverty, the giant wars in the cycle every time. You're like, well, so what if we got people running around in dresses? Quite frankly, as long as you don't try to teach it to my kids or whatever, you want to go off and, you know, think you're a dog or think you're a five-year-old or whatever, that's your issue. We used to call that mental illness. Be free. But the fact is, you're a bellwether, a canary in the coal mine. Now, I want to go to our guest who I'd love to get him on once a week if we can do it and basically co-host with me and give his analysis on what's happening. And when he's in studio next week, I want to get partially, you know, into his new film and why the globalists are so obsessed with the occult. But there's an alternate article out by Michael Moore that fits into a larger cosmology, a fake worldview, that Donald Trump's really a Democrat, that Donald Trump is just doing this to become more famous, that Donald Trump wanted a bigger contract with television. And you read this article, it's the definition of slime. They keep saying, he's going to resign, he's going to resign, it's all fake. Then they mix into this, I saw it on CNN this morning, something that's true. Trump for a decade has wanted to start his own Fox News, and he's toyed with it. He wants to counter what's going on in this country. They've now had a coup and kicked out Roger Ailes for basically made-up reasons. They admit it's a coup. They're going way globalist, not left, globalist right now. So when you look at this, you have to understand they're creating the perception that he's a liar. He's not for real. He doesn't mean what he says. And again, you can go watch the footage of when I was on that big Sunday morning show. It's the biggest in the country. I forget the name of it. McBreen knows the name because he did a little short piece about it. And I'm there like 4 years ago to cover Bilderberg. And I go in and I start saying, hey, they're attacking us. There is a world government. Fluoride in the water is hurting you. Don't laugh at this. And then they cut to go to commercial and kick me off the set. And I start videotaping so I can put it on YouTube because the Bilderberg group members coming in, the chancellor of the exchequer was coming in. That's the head of their treasury, Bilderberg group member. He was meeting that night just an hour away in Watford at the Bilderberg meeting. And it was admitted. So I start interviewing him as he walks in. I walk out in the hall. They say, get out of the building, throw us out. We walk across to a pizza place with Wi-Fi. We order lunch. And we start getting tweets and comments. And then we see the video on YouTube an hour later. They went on TV and they said, that man, as soon as the cameras turned off, said, it's all fake. I'm a fake. None of this is real. I did no such thing. Talk about something that in the old days could have been like a duel in the street or something. I mean, they challenged my honor and said that I was a fraud. But you know what? I had them. I'd already uploaded the Bilderberg video, not even knowing that they'd made that claim, because I wasn't watching TV once I was thrown out by security and thrown out of the building. So again, I then pointed out, hey, here's my video of right when we go to break, I had the phone and just had a feeling to do it and turned it on. And then here comes the Bilderberg guy. And here they are telling me I'm a kook and saying, get out of here. I had it all on tape. In fact, I even taped some right there at the end while it was still on. Started pulling it out and getting it going because I just had a feeling. They almost physically attacked me at CNN when I got in the face. I mean, they had their crew guys and people just going, get out of here. Get out of here. Get your ass out of here. And like, they had weird, like, New York detectives all kind of bowed up, waiting at the bottom. I mean, that got caught on video. So I'm just explaining to you what goes on behind the scenes. And that's what Michael Moore has done, the slime bag. Michael Moore, Trump is self-sabotaging his campaign because he's never really wanted the job in the first place. He's running for president to get a better deal for The Apprentice, close quote. Donald Trump never actually wanted to be president of the United States. I know this for a fact. I'm not going to say how I know it. I'm not saying that Trump and I share the same agent or lawyer or stylist, or if we did, that would have anything to do with anything. So he's telling you that's what happened. And I'm certainly not saying I overheard anything at those agencies or in the hallways at NBC or anywhere else. But there are certain people reading this right now. They know who they are, and they know every word in the following paragraph actually happened. And then he goes on to describe how he made it all up and said, give me a bigger deal. I can run for president and show you how popular I am. Trump was unhappy with his deal and host and star of his hit NBC show, The Apprentice. Simply put, he wanted more money. He had floated the idea before the possibility of running for president in the hopes that the attention from that would make his negotiations position stronger. Now, who knows if that's even partially true, that if back in 2008, 2012, sometimes he would flirt with it to get attention. Sure. But see, now he acts like none of it's real. And then he just goes on to say it's all made up. And then on CNN this morning, and we're going to go to break and come back with Steve Quayle, stevequayle.com, but I wanted to get this out. They were saying the same thing. Trump is getting ready to lose. He's getting ready to step down. He's getting ready to stop. They gave no proof because he wants his own TV network. They know for how many years, 5, 6, 7, that Trump's openly talked about having a patriot nationalist network. And quite frankly, if he loses, he's so angry about the fraud in this country, he wants to keep fighting. He wants to do that and then position his family to run for president. Just like I'm on air and have a platform to fight the New World Order. That's why I do this. Money isn't a bad thing, and I need it to operate and fund our operation. But I've been offered more money than I personally make a year a decade ago. I was offered Glenn Beck's job before he even got syndicated. They said, we've got a couple people we're developing. Have you heard of Glenn Beck? And I said, no, not really. Well, we got a bunch of affiliates around the country that are ready to pick him up. We're going to put him on Clear Channel. We're making a big deal. And, you know, we want you to be involved in this, but you're going to have to do what we tell you. Didn't do it. So, see, they're always spinning it that I, quote, do this for money. Oh, but it's okay that ABC and NBC and CNN and, you know, all these people, it's okay if some of the Fox hosts make $5, $10 million a year. That's okay. It's okay if Rush Limbaugh makes $30 million a year. It's okay. But see, if you're a patriot and you sell books or water filters or films to fund yourself or coffee mugs or gun sights or sunglasses or water filters, oh, it's so dirty. When you question known liars, you're a conspiracy theorist. That's how they operate. But folks have seen through it. And they go get high-quality products, high-quality nutraceutical supplements at InfoWarsLife.com, and it blows your socks off. The X2, the Lung Cleanse, the Super Male Vitality, the Anthroplex, the Living Defense, Harmful Organism, Detoxer, Harmful Organism Cleansing, the Vitamin Mineral Fusion, the Colloidal Silver, the Nootropic Brain Force, the Hillary for Prison Shirts. We're building our own economy, and it's changing the whole media paradigm. I see the stuff we do now being done on Fox. I know for a fact everybody else is copying it and always have. But just because we're trailblazers, because we had to be, we had to build something new and do something different to figure out how to get the light of truth into this world to expose the New World Order. Now, speaking of somebody that's been doing it longer than I have, Steve Quayle of stevequayle.com, straight ahead to break down the latest developments and where he sees the entire planet going. I'm Alex Jones. Stay with us. People like Barry Goldwater in the 40s, 50s, and 60s were the first wave of resistance to globalism. So was the John Birch Society. An individual, I would have to say, marks the second wave would be someone like Steve Quayle or someone like Ron Paul. And then I mark and Drudge marks the start of the third wave. Though Drudge was a lot more successful than I was early on, Drudge and I started right around the same time, 1995 or so. Steve Quayle's going to be with us 20 minutes or 30 minutes in the next hour. Then our reporters join us. This is a brief segment, but I was just talking to Steve Quayle during the break. He's never been so on fire. Everything he was saying was connecting all the dots. Steve, please repeat to the audience what you just said to me over the phone during the break.
Well, Alex, I believe that the whole Hillary for presidency facade that all of the news vomit brokers, meaning the big networks, are putting forth is just to keep us occupied. It appears, based on the events taking place today, that and all the executive orders being signed in the last couple weeks and all the United Nations talk, it will be a miracle, literally, if we have an election. And, you know, I think you and I have talked about this. Let me read you one of Saul Alinsky's rules for radicals, okay? Hey, a new word, radicules. Ridicule is man's most potent weapon. There is no defense. It's irrational. It's infuriating. It also works as a key pressure point to force the enemy into concessions. Now, what's critical in that statement is to understand the denigration of Donald Trump, the absolute lies about Donald Trump, the absolute ridicule that is going on ad nauseum. First of all, I find it interesting that people who have never done anything, never accomplished anything, are basically paid hacks, are being funded by, you know, the billionaires in the background to take on Donald Trump. The reason that I said on George Norrie, Coast to Coast, before Donald announced his, or Mr. Trump announced his run for presidency, is George asked me on the air, I said, are you endorsing, and at that point he wasn't, Donald Trump? And I said, absolutely. I said, when I see who everybody hates, or the people that hate him, I will stand with the guy always that speaks the truth.
Well, that's key. Now, you were for Trump before he even announced, and I had people over the years reach out to me about Donald Trump and how he was a patriot, and I just wasn't paying attention. But he has been really quietly getting ready for this for 30 years. Now, during the break, when we first got you on the line, you were telling me what you wanted to cover today. It was amazing how you were connecting the dots with Greece and with Russia and Ukraine and the Strong Cities initiatives, and suddenly all over the news, we're under UN command, and George Soros' emails are public, how they admit they plan to replace us with jihadis. I mean, this is incredible. This is really happening.
Well, and you've warned about it, I've warned about it. The UN takeover has already been taken over, and I think it's important that people understand from the Greek newspapers. I put one up on my site. You know, it had to go through Google Translate. It's on my alert section, Alex. But the Ukrainians and Russians have started firing at each other. Russia's moved 40,000 troops. So it's not posturing. The other thing that's really troubling is when the whole situation in Turkey went down, I was one of the first guys to say, look, we've got nuclear weapons there.
And now RT and the AP admit the base is surrounded with a whole bunch of nukes. What's happening there? Why don't we just fly the nukes out?
Yep, well, listen, the deal is, and I'm serious about this, every single, jellyfish congressman and senator, they should be absolutely livid, because there's not just, you know, they say 90 B-61 nuclear warheads over there. There are H-bombs at Incirlik. That is NATO's forward staging base. And Russia has effectively, I'm telling you this, they have gelded NATO by going up with Erdogan. And now the Turkish press is calling for, you're ready for this, the seizure of all those nuclear weapons. I said, if Erdogan gets the nuclear weapons and given to him by his friend in the White House, we're in big trouble. And Alex, normally something of that consequence would be so great that you'd think everybody would be heralding it instead of just saying, it doesn't matter. It really matters, ladies and gentlemen. Go look at, do an internet search on hydrogen bombs. You know, they say, they're just...
And by the way, this isn't hype. You were talking a month ago about how jihadis are backing Erdogan. You've got all these coups and counter coups. Now they're suddenly buddies with the Russians. When Erdogan was just shooting down Russian aircraft just a year ago, major power shifts. And by the way, the Russians have sent a bunch of troops in. Fighting is escalating in eastern Ukraine, and it's not even on our news.
Not at all. And here's the thing. I think Vladimir Putin, again, I'm not a Russophile. I'm just saying truth is truth, okay? But because we've become a nation that bathes in lies, wallows in lies like a pig does in mud, that absolutely can no longer think, that chooses to basically be entertained instead of educated, we are ripe for the taking. And what I think is the point that everyone ought to realize this.
Stay there. We got to come right back. But again, a few newspapers are reporting it, but it's not a big news story. It should be. Stay with us. Steve Quayle is our guest, 30 minutes to the next hour. Then we're going to talk to our reporters who are on the ground in Wisconsin in the aftermath of days of civil unrest. Brought to you by George Soros and the Communist Party, and that's literally who the police say were running it, was the Communist Party. We're also going to talk some about True Legends, Episode 2, The Unholy Sea, a new documentary film available at TrueLegendsTheSeries.com, put out by Steve Quayle and his amazing crew. This is Discovery Channel quality and information you won't see anywhere else. True Legends, Episode 2, The Unholy Sea. There's a previous film as well, TrueLegendsTheSeries.com. For us here, we have the Hillary for Prison shirts. We have the Bill Clinton rape shirts, just getting it out there. This guy settled rape cases while they claim they represent all the women. We have Living Defense, the Parasite Cleanse, that is just all of the known herbs concentrated in plant extracts to really flush out your system. Has an amazing effect. You can read about the different rave reviews. That is going to sell out because it's so hard to source. So it's got so many ingredients in it. That's available at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. And I want to thank all the listeners that do get the X2 and the Lung Cleanse and the Super Male Vitality and the other products, because these are great products, number one. But number two, and just as importantly, you're funding this operation. And finally, Amerageddon, the film that was a $5 million budget, is exclusively available on DVD at InfoWarsStore.com. And when you get a second copy of it, you get two of my films, Fall of the Republic and Matrix of Evil, free. I guess we sold out of America's Way by Design, so we had to stop offering that one for free and go to Matrix of Evil. That's excellent as well. But Fall of the Republic is really, I mean, that was made 6 years ago, and everything in it, unfortunately, has basically come true. It just blows people away when they see it. It's what they call evergreen. It's more important today than it was back then. So the toll-free number to call and take advantage of that, Amerageddon the movie, get one copy for $19.95, put it in your library, donate it to the library so that hundreds of people can watch it. It really exposes globalism from a fiction perspective and the invasion of America following an EMP by the United Nations. But then you get the nonfiction films with it when you get a second copy, two films free. That's four films for the price of two. And a great way to give it to your friends, your family, your neighbors, your community. You're also welcome to show it to your church, as Gary Haven has said. You're welcome to put my films on Access Television or air them on broadcast TV or do whatever you want. A lot of stations across the country are owned by patriots. In California and New York, you name it, they just air my films. And on primetime TV sometimes, on UHF, VHF, and cable, and it ends up in the newspaper, and I mean, it has a big effect. I mean, that's what I'm saying. Don't wait for orders from headquarters, folks. Go to the sound of the guns. People are ready to wake up to globalism. They're ready to take action against it. And the new film, Amerageddon, available exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com. And I want to thank all of you that have purchased the film for your support, not just of what Gary's doing and what I'm doing, but of this entire country and this entire world. Okay, I'm going to go now to our guest, Steve Quayle of stevequayle.com, to break down, because just while he was talking about it, I was really ashamed of myself. I'm going to be honest. In the last few days, the Russians caught Ukrainian troops attacking people, shooting people, and blowing stuff up and attempting to blow stuff up inside Russia proper in a provocation. So Russia's moved a bunch of troops up to the border. They're rolling more troops now into the eastern area of Ukraine that has seceded to Russia and has historically been part of Russia, Crimea, that Russia has fought five major wars of and dozens of small wars. I mean, it's just so many, historians can't decide how many wars. Fighting intensifies in East Ukraine combat zone. I mean, this is being reported by foreign major newspapers. Ukraine Today, you name it. This is not really in our news. In our news, the Washington Post says, while the world is distracted, Putin escalates his war in Ukraine. Well, we're going to get the actual clip of his press conference a few days ago and what he said. But notice, I say I'm watching this, and I'm so busy following 2016 and Trump and the stock market and the announcement that the UN is going to run our local police and just Congress pursuing perjury charges against Hillary and fake polls and Obamacare and all these leaks and all this stuff that's happening, that I get Steve Quayle on. And he goes, you know, a war is escalating. Russian FSB foils terrorist attacks plotted by Ukrainian intel agents in Crimea. That's RT. And again, there's been explosions, stuff blowing up, power lines getting severed. This is a real asymmetrical situation going on. And you've got NATO massing troops right there on the border in Poland and other areas with Russia. This is a really serious time to be alive. So if you're a radio listener, you hear me mentioning these headlines, I'm reading headlines in real time. We're throwing on screen at Infowars.com/show. This is what radio is like on television. You see basically everybody going to this format now. I'm proud of the fact Infowars trailblazed it and is the founder of it in this format. Often imitated and many times duplicated. We actually want to be made obsolete by defeating the New World Order. There'll be new problems. We're not offering some utopia, but I don't want things to be this intense. I don't need things to be this riveting. I don't need to have my heart racing all the time. I don't need to be, you know, I mean, there'll always be corruption and stuff to deal with. We'll always be able to have a show, but I don't want it to be so incredibly cutting edge and so incredibly dangerous that I'm way out here on the tip of the spear. I want to dial back the evil. I want to end it if we could, but, you know, humans are inherently fallen, so we're always going to have problems. The issue is, this is real, folks. This is happening, and all over the world, there's major destabilization. So get into what's happening. You've got the floor, Steve Quayle. Please don't pause or thank me. Just take over, or I'll interrupt. Get into why all hell's breaking loose historically at this one time and what the globalists are really planning, Steve Quayle.
Well, this is a going for it, Alex. There's no holding back now. We've warned, we've warned, we've warned, and now it's all in play. The internet goes down into foreign hands October 1st, I guarantee you there's a secret deal that the UN will consider anything that you, I, or anybody who's talking against
They already
globalism.
Admit that. I'm sorry. They already admit that they're going to apply the German and French rules of censorship, and Soros got caught. I said I wouldn't interrupt. I got to back up what you're saying, because you're saying it intuitively. Steve, it's admitted in his new emails. George Soros is running a whole group to target people that criticize radical Islam and shut us down. And now the mayor of London is saying he's going to arrest you if you criticize Islam. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, that's it, Alex. And here's the thing. Again, I want to say this because I wasn't clear enough last time I was on your show last week. The plan is this, ladies and gentlemen, to generate a third world war under the Muslim auspices. And in doing so, that provides the fulfillment of their prophecy that it will be on the back of a global nuclear conflagration that the Iman Mahdi comes on the scene. Now, Alex, I said that 20 years ago, and most people thought, you know, well, Ben, they thought everything that we were talking about was crazy. But here's the thing. We're now seeing Russia say, and I just got an email from somebody saying, why are you guys kissing the Russians, you know what? I'm not. I'm saying this. Listen, it is counterintuitive to want the death of however many billion. And see, this is where we are the most naive people in the United States, dumbed down chemically and emasculated from the xenoestrogens in the water. The bottom line is that, you know, I told people, I guess America got stupid when its sperm could no longer count. And it's because of, and you think that's a statement of just, you know, being off the wall. Listen, we are seeing right now the implementation of a pre-World War III scenario. When Russia and China announced, China actually announced shooting one of their new satellites into space that is basically just going to be, you can't break their encryption. Well, what most people don't know is Russia put some of their data on it too. Now, they used to have a system by which if certain command centers of theirs go dead, their military installations and all their hidden weapons are fired almost concurrently and simultaneously.
The doomsday plan.
You got it. And they have another name for it. And forgive me, Alex. I used to talk about it all the time. But here's the deal. Look at this, Alex. We are, what is it today? The 17th. The 17th of August.
Well, the Israelis call it the Samson option. But I'm sorry I'm interrupting. Go ahead.
No, that's the Samson option. You know, that's Israel. The Russians have, I think it's called the dead hand option or something like that. Samson option is Israel's, very similar to it. And I'm sure we got it the same thing.
That means bring the whole world down.
Yep. And here's the thing. You know, let me share this. I'm going to go to the 13th rules of radicals because I've got to tell you, look at what they're doing. This is why they're doing to Donald Trump.
And it's why they're so arrogant. It's why they're moving on every front. They're making their move.
Listen, pick the target, freeze it, personalize it, and polarize it. Cut off the support network and isolate the target from sympathy. Go after people. And listen to this, non-institutions, people hurt faster than institutions. So we're seeing this played out. And I believe, and I'm going to say this again, you know, God's got his Trump card to play. I can tell you when I make that statement, you know, I'll get so many hate emails, I might as well, you know, put them out as a hate chronicle.
I forgot that you biblically mentioned Trump way before he announced. How did you do that?
Well, here's the thing. I look at who a man's enemies are, and I think that we're watching right now the total, if you will, the whole world, historically, when the odds are absolutely against speaking the truth. God always has what I call the ram in the bush, okay? And it's based on Abraham and Isaac and offer up Isaac, but God provided the ram for the sacrifice.
It's the deus ex.
I'm sorry?
Deus ex.
Yep. So the thing is that where we're at right now is that it's all in play. Seriously, Alex, I don't know how you think at night when you know, try to shut down. I don't shut down very well.
No. I slept great. Now I just dream about work. The entire night I'm just working.
Well, you know, the bottom line is, and that's an overused statement of mine, makes people crazy. When you cut through all the crap, here's where we're at. We are at World War III time. It's up to the living God to decide when, you know, his hand of protection is taken off.
And the average American is totally asleep.
Yep. Yep. And this is one of the most important things I've seen. And I am telling people, look, get it. Do you get it? The internet you've known is going away. That's what Matt Drudge said when he was in your studio. And remember, Supreme Court judge. Okay, so let's take it up to now.
On October 1st, the United Nations has handed the entire control of the internet, the rules, the regulations, the DNC takedown orders, all of it. It is now happening.
And, Alex, over the years I've been on talk radio, and some generals in your area, you know, multi-stars and more stars than people are aware of, basically have absolutely validated the U.N. troops. When people say, where are they? I don't see them. You know, these are just U.N. vehicles being made.
We're going under U.N. control, U.N. regulation, under UNESCO. Loretta Lynch, who has been a U.N. lawyer for over 10 years, she worked for the United Nations World Criminal Court, and she's announcing our police are going under UN regulations. They are giving them UN orders.
Absolutely. And now here's what people have got to understand. The amount of weapons in this country that were pre-staged. You and I did shows. I can remember the topics. I don't remember the years. Almost 15 years ago. Even when Bo Gritz was talking about all the ships coming in to the Los Angeles or Long Beach shipyards.
That's
Seattle.
My next question. A lot of that was old stuff. Now it's newer Abrams. It's newer fighting vehicles, armored vehicles, the brand new fighting vehicles by the thousands and thousands being pre-deployed. I've confirmed in rural areas everywhere to take on Patriots. They admit they're training to take on gun owners and veterans. This is insane.
Well, it's not only insane, but the amount of men and materiel that has been moved into underground. Remember this, ladies and gentlemen, under George Bush Sr., and you remember, Alex, that he closed down all these military bases. Well, they didn't go out of business. They didn't board them up.
And you and I said that wasn't the case because of our sources, and then they even admitted in that legislation, the Emergency Centers Establishment Act, that they'd retrofitted them as emergency centers for at least 3 million Americans. That was just the first announcement, and indeed they were set up, and that actually happened.
Right, and so the thing is that even in Montana, the amount of weapons, and by the way, there are pictures of multiple rocket launchers, and it's not all U.S. material. I've talked to C-130 pilots. I've talked to
Well, let's break down then how they would roll out different scenarios, because obviously it's all deception. Start a war with the Russians, then claim that the Patriots are working with the Russians, then start going after us, and it's a U.N. globalist leftist attack here, but then a lot of Americans get in line with it because they believe they're fighting Russian agents. That's kind of the angle I see them developing.
Well, yeah, and that it's not only that, but the Chinese are, you know, actively. I don't think people.
I was
going to
say the Chinese will be the muscle of the New World Order. That's been known.
Yeah, but here's the thing, okay? The amount of advanced weapon systems. When I had nothing to do with my life in the early days of talk radio, I just, you know, read Jane's Defense Weekly and talked to a lot of different people. I'll tell you one thing I've learned, and this is true. Russia will tell you what they're going to do. Russia will say, don't do it. Now, I get it.
That's right. Russia said,
keep
deploying missiles that we know have nukes in them. We're going to have to strike them.
Yep. And now we're even having to recognize the fact that, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, half of the U.S. military, who, by the way, declared war on God, cannot, and I'm talking the living God, you can be a Satanist, you can be a Wiccan priest, you can be whatever you want to be, you can be this, that, or the other thing, but if you're a Christian, you're out. But half of their flying assets aren't even fit to fly. And now we've got the lowest combat readiness. And by the way,
so we've been sabotaged. We've been sabotaged.
We've been sabotaged. We are destroyed from enemies within, traitors from within. And this is the thing that gets me. It's not the fact that you've got the biggest liar in history caught with their biggest hand in the biggest pocketbook of literally hundreds of billions of dollars.
The only way you save them is starting a war and then people get in line.
Yep. And that they're still. Basically, people are saying, we don't care about that. I think this, Alex, I think that what you're seeing right now, not only in the court of earthly perception, but in the court of heaven, all of the indictments against the United States, you see, everybody used to think, we're the United States, we're the greatest. I love the country that we once had. I cannot even identify the country we now exist in. What you have done over the years is say, this is what's in play, this is what's in play, this is what's in play. What I've done over the years is saying, here is how it's going to play out, you too. But what I'm saying is this, is that we're now at the nexus point. We are at the point, we are at the center of the hub of the bicycle tire. With
point of no return, Event Horizon. Let me say this to you then. I've talked about having storable food and stuff because I thought it was a possibility of economic collapse or other things. You see all the disasters and things. I mean, it's just a smart thing to do. Old-timers always did it. You know, in modern times, look how domesticated we are. We don't. I've gone from thinking, okay, there's a chance it'll happen to a probability, now to a certainty, talking to all the top economists across the board. The question is just when, with the elites building armored fortresses in all these remote areas of the world, already leaving. I told people that 6 years ago, and it really accelerated. Now it's admitted, you know, the New York Times and the Washington Post and the London Guardian. We're not excited, Steve Quayle and I, about being right about all this. Yeah, I'm sitting here personally having to get ready, getting storable food, medical supplies, and things here at the office, and security plans, and solar generators, and gas generators, because we're just hoping somehow people in our government or stop the globalists who are admitted foreign agents. Our own government, folks, is hacking. By the way, it's not the Russians. We've now confirmed that they did some earlier stuff. Patriots are the ones leaking the Soros stuff, the Hillary stuff, to WikiLeaks and everybody else. They're killing people that are leaking it. But we've never had so many leaks now that are actually very good quality, but super dangerous to even try to vet. I mean, that's above my pay grade, quite frankly, even because finally the government realizes, oh, my God, we've been set for self-destruct. It's sabotage. People finally get that they really are trying to ban the word mother and father and are doing it. They really are saying Christians are the enemy. They really are saying veterans are going to have to be rounded up and reeducated. And Hillary's even saying reeducation camps now. It's even on the news. They're getting ready for something huge. They've got evil looks in their eyes. They're running around like chickens with their heads cut off in preparation. Suddenly, red brigades are popping up everywhere I go. I see communists and communist flags just running around giggling and laughing. The foreign powers are trying to set up cop killer squads. You can clearly see we're being brought into something really nasty, and this isn't a beta test. That's what you're getting at here. And is there any way to try to avert this, and what do you think the timeline is if we're unable to stop it? Because, I mean, they admit shooting war is intensified between Russia and proxy army Ukraine with NATO. We are now fighting the Russians. It's been going on, but it's escalating now. We've got video that nobody's seen in the West of Putin about to come up, translated. I'm not trying to scare people here. I'm telling you, folks.
Well, can I tell you something? If everything we've told them gently, increasing the feverish pitch of giving them documents. See, again, this. Remember this. You're dealing, I'm dealing, we're dealing with the remnant. You cannot wake up a big enough body of people to vote a difference. What it's going to take, and you asked me this too last time we were on the show together, is an awareness. Now, let me just say one thing about Amerageddon. I told Gary, I said, Gary Haven, I said, you've covered 35 issues that it's imperative that people get that DVD and send it to their loved ones or their doubted ones, because the time that he you know, released it early through you exclusively, Alex, was timed with the headlines. There were probably, I don't know, 10, 12 headlines that I picked up on my website. UN this, UN that, Obama this, Obama that, Lynch this, Lynch that. So the bottom line is that, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to see something that is so timed, so specific to the time you're living in now, you better get that film. And I'm saying seriously, it is that good, it is that important, it is that timely. And I would say that, Alex, your special is good. It's not enough just to buy one and see one. Buy one, give it away, get it to the people that absolutely are kind of fence-sitters. And I'll say this, Alex, the spiritual realm of this is increasing. Every day on Drudge, more demon stuff, more horrific Satan stuff. They're back to eating people's faces off. I remember saying that 20 years ago, and you know, even you thought I was a little off, you know, off my rocker in those days. But the point is that when you see something in the future, most people cannot grasp it because they don't yet see it playing out, because they go into that
But now it's gone from probability to almost certainty that we're seeing major wars, and our elites are so crazy. Samantha Power is laughing about war with Russia. This is Putin a month and a half ago. We played this clip many times. We've got a new clip, but we've got to translate it into English. That'll be in a special report on the Nightly News tonight, where he's doing even more dire warnings just yesterday about the proxy army starting war with Russia. And George Soros admits he started the overthrow of Ukraine and the war with Russia. But then they tell us in our media, Russia started it. Russia didn't start it. So let's play this clip of Putin warning the world.
How do you not understand that the world is being pulled in an irreversible direction? That is the problem. But they pretend like nothing's going on. I don't even know how to get through to you people anymore. And what do they say? This is part of a defense potential, not the offensive weaponry, that these systems are meant to, quote, prevent aggression. This is not the truth. This is incorrect. A missile defense system is part of a whole system of offensive military potential. And all this works as part of a whole that includes offensive missile launchers.
And then he goes on
one
to say,
complex block.
Do you realize the peril? Do you realize the danger? I'm not going to play it all because we've already played it like 10 times. But you'd think that'd be on U.S. news when the Russian president is talking about this and there's a shooting war going on. Instead, they're trying to teach five-year-olds how to be transsexuals, Steve Quayle.
Well, again, I would call this the Judas news, okay? What basically is, and Alex, imagine, if you've got somebody draw a cartoon, imagine a pedestal TV studio, NBC, CBS, ABC, with a bombed-out, destroyed New York, and you've got the television cameras on the set, but everything is cut off. Everything is destroyed, and the people are, you know, the people that are the broadcasters are all disheveled, you know, whether they're male or female, asking each other, well, do you think, what do you think this really means? That's exactly, I think people are beyond mind-controlled zombies.
That's like Fox News this weekend goes, coming up, is the media biased against Donald Trump? And they came back and concluded it wasn't, Steve. That's supposedly conservative TV now.
Right, and I'll give you a good example. It's like a group of vampires at a vampire convention, okay? And one of them says, you know, we'd have a lot more fans if we didn't kill them all and drink their blood. They all vote, basically, you know, that sounds like good. We need public opinion on our side. The minute it turns dark, man, they're out, you know, chomping on the necks and sucking the blood of everybody. They are blood-sucking parasites who have sucked the life out of the American people. The bankers are blood-sucking parasites that have taken the hope for the future.
And they don't know when to quit. They don't know when to quit. They don't know when to quit. They
have
to
just... Can I tell you something? They can't, because they're like jackals and hyenas, and they're like a bunch of African beasts, you know, on a dead carcass. See, that's what we're seeing, Alex, and that's what breaks my heart. Look, I wish I would have been wrong. And I'm sorry.
I tell you, these hyenas are going to sit there and eat wildebeest till the nukes go off. They just don't care.
And they're feasting on the lazy flesh of, and I'm serious, and people don't understand.
No, you're right. Back in 70 seconds, Steve Quayle's our guest. I'm Alex Jones. Powerful info. I'm telling you, this is not hyped. This is how much trouble we're in. And the average person's out there with soccer moms just sucking their thumb. By the way, you know, we have to crack a big nut every day here with over 50 crew members, reporters, writers, researchers, switchers, producers, researchers, you know, investigative journalists. And then you got one maintenance guy and some customer service and the shipping department. I mean, that we're a small crew, but it's expensive. I mean, if I lived in New York City or something, we could have 15 people, not 50-something. We have a lot of contractors, too, more than 70 people total that make this the ship sail every day. I'm not going to sit here and plug right now, but they just came in. We're offering, when you get two Amerigeddons, the new film, exclusively available, $5 million budget, exposing the New World Order in a fiction account, near future. You get two of my films free. Well, the problem is we sold out of the films we were already offering free. So we had to change it again. And now we're about to sell out of Matrix of Evil and Fall of the Republic. So the new special is buy two copies and get two Alex Jones films free. Police State 4 and the Police State Trilogy. That's four films, all of my Police State films, and the two Amerigeddons for the price of the two Amerigeddons. So, and that'll probably sell out real quick, too. But, I mean, I guess we're getting low on my DVDs because we're selling so many of these. So that's a godsend to help fund the operation. So thank you for your support. The long segment's coming up, Steve Quayle, but we got 3 minutes to break. Please continue, sir. I've never seen you on fire like this. I guess it's just the times we're living in.
We're about ready to see events that, with no pun intended, are going to go atmospheric. And outside of praying Christians, and I mean this, I believe with all my heart that what we're going to see is God supernaturally delivering people in places of this country. But years ago, I said on the radio, as to specific areas of sin, so will their judgment be. We're seeing episodic quakes happening on the West Coast. We've always heard, oh, California's going to fall off into the ocean. We've seen so much Satanism. We've seen so much demon possession. And ladies and gentlemen, whether you believe it's real or not, this stuff is real. And Alex, that's the key. You can't just blame. Somebody wants to blame this faction or that faction. They want to blame the Jews. They want to blame the Jesuits. They want to blame the Catholics. They want to blame me. They want to blame you. But they don't get the fact that, look, it's not a question of blame. It's identifying the root of evil. And these people, and you've said it, and you've brought your whole, I guess you'd say, your whole view to this point, that there is a supernatural entity, a supernatural wisdom directing the total destruction of all morality, all values, borders, language, culture, and the...
And it's out to get the country and the family and God. It particularly hates Christians. And if you expand on this, and the globalists will go out of their way to kill a Christian for no reason. Obama won't let Christians get out of Syria. And if you looked at it from a science fiction perspective, it's like an interdimensional invasion is basically what this is.
Oh, really? And can I tell you something? Years ago, I said on talk radio, and this is important, real quick, that the unseen would become visible and that the things of men's nightmare would come into the physical realm. So when you see all the, if you will, the gorish, ghastly, everything Hollywood has pretty much produced is leading us to
they admit
time.
Now with all the Hollywood shows and Super Bowl things, with all the Satanism, they believe they're bringing this power in. They admit they're doing rituals.
Absolutely. It's ritual magic. It's serious. And by the way, the Satanists believe in the power of the entity they serve. I wish the Christians would absolutely have a revelation from the living God that greater is he, the Lord Jesus Christ.
But that's a good point. I agree. Why are the Satanists, when we come back, suddenly coming out of the woodwork? Why are they being so obvious now? It's like, again, it's like all hell's breaking loose and it's only intensifying.
Well, it is simply because the salt has lost its savor, and the light of the world, the gospel of Jesus Christ, has gone out. Now, people hate to hear me say that. They like to hear what I know, but they don't want to hear this talk about Jesus. Well, Jesus is the one that told us all this is going to happen in the book of Revelation.
Well, I'll tell you this right now. I've been fighting the globalists for 25 years, and I tell you, there's one thing they hate, and that's the name Jesus Christ. And
amen.
I tell you, that's the power, and it's real. They hate it for whatever reason. You atheists and people don't, you know, get it. You're off in your own la-la land. But your elite masters are a bunch of devil-worshipping, Lucifer-loving trash. We'll be back. Steve Quayle's our guest for another 20 minutes or so. Then our crew joins us from on the ground in Milwaukee. They're about to come back. There were a Trump rally last night. Covered some of the attempts by the communists. That's who the police said it was. A communist came from Chicago and stirred up a black cop shooting a black guy, supposedly waving a gun. They're saying the black cop, though, has a history of corruption problems. Okay, whatever. Just don't burn down your own neighborhood and shoot random people because of it. I mean, you talk about mind control, folks. I don't get off on looking at people doing horrible things and say, look at those bad people. I feel better about myself. But I don't like being criticized when I see people dragging whites out of cars, beating them up, calling them racist names, killing people, you know, in other cases, or shooting up a black lady's car because she, you know, bumped into Black Lives Matter people. It is this incredible entitlement of a bunch of dumb teenagers who just want to swagger around and be thugs. And all you're going to do is make the police hate you that much more and cause a bigger problem. We do not want to have a war with the police. We want to get our communities under local control. They're going to use this crisis to bring in the Strong City Initiative, UN-run police. That's mainstream news. Quite frankly, I'm pinching myself at how accurate I've been. And I used to think I was going out on a limb a lot of stuff. And usually it turns out it's worse than I said. People accuse me of exaggeration. No. No. Steve Quayle now, who I never thought Steve Quayle was crazy. I thought, you know, this guy's a little eccentric and you know, this is just, you know, really almost like science fiction. Geoengineering, aluminum oxide. He was the first guy I heard 20 plus years ago talking about their spraying aluminum. It's all admitted now. The Department of Energy admits $5 billion a year to spray aluminum on us to, quote, test guarding us from the sun. And then the aluminum level's rising and the plants are dying everywhere. I drive out in the hill country. It's not oak wilt. I've talked to the horticulturalist. I've talked to the arborist. And they say, no, Alex, there's the aluminum in the soil. I mean, it's like space aliens are running the planet trying to kill everything. The planet's being killed in front of us in slow motion. They're genetically splicing everything. They're playing God, just like the Bible said. And I never lost faith in God. But, you know, I got sick of being drugged to church twice a week when I was a kid. And my dad pinching me to stay up, you know, in three-hour church services. We've got to go to the, you know, minister to the, you know, to the old folks home this weekend. Oh, great. Another Christmas, you know, giving homeless people soup. I mean, I'll admit it. I wasn't some angel. I wanted to, you know, go play baseball or, you know, get in bare knuckles fist fights or go pick up, you know, the cheerleader down the street. But I thank God my parents did that because I got a real Christian education. And by that, I mean really caring about people. But I'll tell you, you know, sitting there on Christmas Eve, freezing your ass off in downtown Dallas, feeding homeless people is not fun when you're 14 years old. But I tell you, comparing somebody like my parents that are so good and would never screw anybody over, I thought of myself as like nasty and evil compared to them. I look at the enemy and who they are. They live to hurt innocent people. They live to lie. They live to be dishonorable. And that's why they've got the jump on us, is good people just cannot imagine. You know, Steve said he was a racy guy in film school and doing wild stuff. It almost seems like God does kind of pick the bad boys to take on the New World Order, though, Steve. And that's why I want to say to the other bad boys and girls out there, a lot of times the devil will try to convict your heart as the accuser and say, you've done bad stuff in your life, and you've been a mean person, you've had hateful thoughts, and you know, didn't need to stomp on that guy's head after he was already down, or you didn't need to, you know, do this or that. But that's the devil trying to make us feel guilty so we don't get involved. Look, God forgives us all as soon as we really do repent. And then once we take action against evil. But I find so many of the real people that could take down the New World Order say, I just can't do it. I'm too evil. I've done bad things. God doesn't care as long as you repent of it and take action. Right, Steve?
Here's the thing. There is no, all sin is forgivable through the blood of Jesus Christ and repentance, you know. And look, I was out of control, okay? I've shared my testimony on major shows.
I was out of control.
And look, I'm not proud of it, but the Bible says he who's forgiven much loves much, okay? And I'm telling
Prodigal
everybody
son.
Out there, Alex, and you're saying the same thing right now. We're in agreement. There is nobody listening to us beyond the grace and the forgiveness of the living God. When God said God's love, I got news for you. You can't say that in the Islamic faith, that God is love, you know. You can't say that. Jesus said, no greater love has this than a man lays down his life for a friend. And then Jesus, you know, let me just deal with the name of Jesus. Where did it go wrong? You can see, you can name any name, you can have any rock star, you can have any porn, you can have any words that are so disgusting put out there, and all the different acts between all the different 31 flavors of non-human designation. But at the end of the day, Alex, the thing is there's only one name that's hated beyond all names, and that's the name of Jesus Christ. Jesus said they hated me without a cause. They're going to hate you. But you ask why it's this way. Because the churches, you know, I finally figured out, I think just the other day, that the word puke and pew have the same sound, you know, and yes. I call the pastors that are sellouts to Satan pukes in the pulpit. You know, look, God never wanted his people to be entertained. He wanted them to be changed, and that's what we're talking about. So I hear, you know, the most important thing that I can tell everybody for preparation, and as one of the founders of the prep movement, you know, decades ago, 30-some years ago now, the bottom line is get right with Jesus, because it's not enough to just, you know, look, they're coming to kill a lot of us. If they had their way, they'd kill all of us. But Jesus said, don't fear he who can kill your body, but rather fear him who can send you to hell. And see, there's no fear of God, okay? But I want to go to one more rule of radical, because this is it. You brought up the police, okay? If you push a negative hard enough, it will push through and become a positive. Violence from the other side can win the public to your side, because the public sympathizes with the underdog. I have been pleading. I have friends in law enforcement, so do you. I have friends in the military, so do you. I have friends, oh, and boy, do I have enemies on the opposite side. But the point being is I warned that civil war was coming. I warned that the whole point would be to turn the police against the people and the people against the police. And I said to both of them, I said, don't buy that. I said to the black gangs, I said to the Latino gangs, this is years ago, 15 years ago, don't buy it. You're going to be used. And when they're
now,
done,
I remember you said it all first, Steve. You've been the most accurate. It's crazy.
Well, I would say this. It's because that was my calling in God. You know, and all I'm saying, look, I tell people, look, don't believe me, but you can do the same thing, Alex. You can present videos. You can present, in essence, every video you've done, every video
I've sat here with Nightline and the host of ABC Nightly News and showed him six clips of world leaders calling for planetary government, world government, global governance. He looked at me and he said, Alex, that's different world government than what you're talking about. And then at dinner, he admitted, look, you're not a bad guy. I like you. I just got to do this for my, this is the job I do. And right, I just couldn't believe that. It's just like, wow, you know?
That's like Judas going to Jesus after betrayal and saying, you know, Jesus, I was low on some cash, so I just needed 30 pieces of silver, and forgive me because I really didn't mean it. Well, look, betrayal's betrayal.
How do they sell out so easy? I mean, I don't get how you can put a gun to my head and say, kill an innocent child, we're going to kill. I'd say, pull that freaking trigger. I just don't get why people,
you know,
want acceptance.
I got to share this with you. You're going to love this. I had a meeting with a Russian spy master. I won't use his name. Very cool guy. Set up for me by a former agent of his, you know, the opposite side. He was with the Central Intelligence Agency. And, you know, the guy looked at me, very powerful man. This is in Reno. And he said to me, he said, ah, you Americans. He said, you betray your country for so little money. He says, at least when we do betray our country, we do it for millions. You do it for tens of thousands. You know, and that spoke to me, Alex, because I understood why. I mean, I'm not saying sell out anything, but what I'm telling you is this, is that when you control all of the dialogue, when you absolutely give false evidence appearing real, that's what fear is, obviously an acronym. But the point I'm trying to make is, you know, they question our sources. We bust our asses, forgive the language. That would be the burrows that we bring all of our burdens in on just to cover it. The point being is we do this. We go out. We do massive amounts of research. We spend the money we make. And how many times you heard this? You guys just sell fear to sell your books or to sell your gold. You're a fearmonger, blah, blah, blah. No, listen, what we're doing is fighting for the last vestiges of humanity.
Yeah, normally revolutionaries rob banks and stuff. You know, and yep. ISIS sells sex slaves, you know, to fund themselves. We sell high-quality products to fund ourselves. And I'm just, but the good news is the audience gets that's all a load of crap. I mean, all I want is more money to get more people and a bigger organization to fight these people, not because I want to be number one, but because I want to defeat the New World Order. That's why I'm so excited behind the scenes to be talking to some of the biggest new media out there and to know they're actually patriots. And I'm just telling them, hey, you find the people that are better than I am and better crew, I'm ready to just turn my power over to you. I am ready right now to step back. Paul Watson's maybe halfway there, but he just didn't have the stamina. I mean, I am ready right now. I do not want to do this. I do not want to be the tip of the spear. I mean, I would imagine, Steve, you get exhausted sometimes. But it's a burning, isn't it? Like Ezekiel and the bones.
Yeah, it's just like fire shot on my bones. And listen, Alex, I said this. I had this conversation probably at least once a week for every week I've been on talk radio. God, are you sure I'm the right guy to be doing this, Lord?
I have conversation every day. I tell you, I just want somebody else to come in here.
Yeah, me too.
Other people are so jealous of other media. And it's like they're speaking Martian to me or something. It's like we're not in competition with each other. We have the new world order that wants to literally kill 80%+ of the public publicly. A huge planet. Our sperm count's down over 90%. Breast cancer's up 3,000%. We're dying. We're under attack. This is not about who's the biggest. This is about defeating the new world order.
We're seeing genocide. We're seeing suicide. We're seeing fratricide. We're absolutely seeing everything. Now, here's the deal. The devil wants to kill every last man, woman, and child. The devil wants to destroy the planet. So he's got the willing chemtrail people in geoengineering.
And you look at it, Steve, there's no doubt it's the devil. Look, the devil didn't exist, then the mass consciousness or whatever of the elite does. Because they'll go, as I said, a million miles out of their way to screw somebody when it doesn't even help them. They're evil. Sorry,
they're
go ahead.
Evil. And that's the thing. How does evil, free will, people argue that. But here's the deal, Alex. The elite are being promised they get off this planet to a new, if you will, Eden-like
planet. And you said that 20 years ago, and now Ray Kurzweil and all the top Google people and all of them say, I'm going to live forever. I'm going to merge with machines. Well, if that's the case, then, but they go, oh, but we got to kill all of you first. It's like their God tells them, you got to kill everybody. And when there's 100 of you left, we're going to merge and become gods and blast off to another planet. I mean, why do they buy into that?
Well, they buy into it because they don't ever have to face eternal judgment. Every headline from the billionaires, what's their number one concern? To live forever. They got all the money, so they're going to work to live forever. Number two, they're going to be able to, if you will, that appetite that you see that they always want more and more and more, the best definition for lust, okay, power lust, and this is what it's about. I had a very rich man once tell me, Steve, it's not about the power. This is a guy who's dead now. He said, it's not about the money. He said, it's always about the power and control over others' lives. And he said, it is, if you will, bragging rights when you...
And the problem is a really powerful man doesn't want to run other people's lives. He wants to teach them the skills he has.
Yeah, absolutely. But Alex, here's the deal. The most evil... Jesus said it. And when I say the love of money, I'm talking about the control of money. The love of money is the root of all evil. The control of money is the control of all evil. When we talk about bankers, and we've gone through everything from the Federal Reserve you know, Committee of 300, Jekyll Island, all that stuff. When it's all said and done, people are seeing it right now. The middle class is dead. So what does Hillary Clinton want to say? She said, I'm going to tax the middle class. Why don't you just come right out and say she wants them all destroyed, turned into Soylent Green?
Take the Rothschilds. They released in a magazine review 3 years ago photos of themselves at a castle doing Eyes Wide Shut stuff. They're throwing it in our face.
Right. And here's the thing that most people don't understand is that when you're talking about the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, when you're talking about the most powerful, and by the way, there's even money people behind the scenes that are as wealthy, if not wealthier than they are. They're not household names. They haven't even been brought up in our circles, but there are.
I know who they are. A lot of it is the black nobility, formerly from Italy, and some other groups.
But Alex, it's also fallen angels. People don't understand that when Satan rebelled against God, that literally a third of the angels fell with them. And they can't get it through their head that even the Apostle Paul said they can transform themselves as angels of light. They're angels of darkness. Angel means messenger. But the point being is that now we have all the transhumanism stuff. We've got singularity.
They're getting us ready to see heavy duty stuff.
Yeah, and you know, when I wrote my book, and I want to make a pitch for this because I don't know anybody who tagged genetic Armageddon from the Christian believing patriot side earlier than I did.
Nobody.
Okay? And the same thing is with the book Xenogenesis. Xenogenesis is my last book on that whole subject matter of what man. Here it is in a nutshell, 30 seconds. They want every man, woman, and child that is of God creation through their, you know, ancestors dead. They want to insert demon-possessed robots. This is going to make Stephen King's novel seem like Little League. They want to bring on the new man, the Uberman, the Ubermensch, and they want that to be totally void of God. They want none of the restraints of God. They want none of the morality of God. What they want is basically a Caligulan orgy of intelligence and fulfillment for their unbridled lust, and it all goes right back to demons. That's why there's a story out that Susan Duclos wrote on my site, and she's showing one of those cards, you know, the Illuminati card game, and I forgot about that card, but it's the unleashing of demons.
By the way, why don't you, that guy literally has his office 2 miles from mine. He will never talk to me. I've tried for 10 years to talk to him, and it is uncanny, those cards.
Yep, he won't talk to me either. I've tried to.
Now, Steve Quayle, we're almost out of time.
But Alex, here, let me say this. Our new DVD is really critical. It's not just about ancient stuff. Orwell said, they who control the past, you know, determine the future.
Got it.
I say the greatest cover-up and cover-over history is the cover-up.
No, it's TrueLegendsTheSeries.com, True Legends Episode 2, The Unholy Sea, and next week we're going to have you in studio to cover that, at least part of the in-studio interview. We're going to play some of those clips here, stevequayle.com as well. Steve, listen, looking at this, it's clear these elites are into degeneracy. And people think of degeneracy as a guy wanting a hot woman or whatever. Degeneracy is wanting to blow the planet up as a sacrifice, wanting to override it, being told you're going to get total power. And we see Peter Thiel, who I'm not saying is a bad guy, he does some good libertarian things, saying he wants to live forever and obsessed with ambrosia and the young of the blood and blood transfusions. The media is acting like that's something new. But the Queen of England's mother, before she died, for decades, would get whole body blood transfusions every month. I mean, that's BBC News. What is this vampiric obsession we're seeing?
Okay, and that's a basic premise of Christianity. That's why when Jesus shed his blood, when people, and this is cool, this is the cool part of, and Alex, I'm sorry that, you know, you had to go through what you went through, but it made you who you are today. You see, the blood is where the life is. So a vampire, when he sucks the blood out of something, he sucks the life out. That's what's happened to the economy, the vampire economy. That's what's happened to our lives. That's what big Medicare and Medicaid and
it's
all
slavery.
They're all doing. They're sucking our blood. So here is the answer. The answer is for everyone to just ask honestly, especially the atheists and agnostics, Jesus, if you're real, reveal yourself to me. Because I can tell you this, there is no place in history, and I'm a pretty, verse researcher on that, where I can see that as it pertained to the people of God, when God's people cried out unto the Lord, he delivered them against insurmountable odds.
And that's why they put in all these state-run fake churches that are totally controlled. You go in them, you feel the spirit of evil. The big, you know, most of the mega churches, if a mega church isn't evil, they try to shut it down. Those are the good guys, folks, usually when you see that happening. And so God understands this, obviously, that so you have the blood of Christ that you take on spiritually, genetically fills you so that you're immune from them, at least your spirit, if not your body. And so we have to ask God, because God's free will, unlike the devil, we have to ask God into us to basically transmute us and turn us into something else so that we transcend this.
Well, yeah, and in quantum physics, it's called superposition, because the scripture says, in Jesus Christ, in him we live and move and have our being, and, you know, we're seated with Jesus Christ in heavenly places. Well, how does that fit on earth? It's exactly what you just said. We're talking about a dimensional ship. We're talking about...
Sure, and let's expand, though. We have to ask God through the dimension to come into us, because God's free will. In closing, in 2 minutes, I remember the New York Times when Prometheus came out, the last Alien movie. And then the brother of the director went and jumped off a cliff the next day or off a bridge. A lot of weird stuff going on there. That in that film, they, and the New York Times admitted that this, whatever you call it, transpermia, is actually what most elites believe and what genetic engineers believe, because they've now looked at the genetics and know that it didn't just accidentally happen. So secretly they admit that most of the globalists in the New York Times actually believe we were put here by aliens.
Yes, and that's what our Unholy Sea, the DVD number 2, is all about. It's preparing the people and the Catholic Church, and because of Catholicism, Roman Catholicism is such a major part of the planet's belief system, they're preparing, the Catholic Church is leading the way to accept an alien savior. And I got to tell you, from all over the world, including Catholics, they're saying, now I get it. They love the Unholy Sea DVD, and it's true legends of Sirius.
Oh, I was in Rome last year, and right up there by the Vatican, they have the Vatican Observatory, and the Pope says, get ready for the aliens, and because they do a fake alien arrival, though.
Yeah, well, and see, that's the deal. When in our DVD, going to Mount, and by the way, Alex, it's that important. If you were to say to me, okay, Steve, I'm 65, okay, I just turned 65 last week, or 2 weeks ago. The bottom line is, this, in my opinion, if you take everything I know, everything I've done, everything I've...
Stay there, come back in two minutes, and we're going to Jakari Jackson, Rob doing this. I want to finish up with this. We're at a critical point, though. I mean, this is a historic point. Now, to be clear, I already knew that the head of Breitbart was looking at joining the Trump campaign 2 months ago. I'm just going to leave that alone at that. Bannon reached out to me a few times. I was so busy, I never got back with him. I should have. But he now is the head of the campaign. But this is to bring a lot of internet modern knowledge. Manafort is needed to stop the steal at the electoral level. And also in the general election to watch for fraud. He worked for Reagan, you name it, did a great job. So this is not even a demotion for Manafort. Now, I made some phone calls this morning, confirmed all this, when I got up and noticed that this announcement had been made. I heard about it months ago. It was being looked at. And we're going to see if Stone can pop in. He's been blowing my phone up for an hour. I hadn't checked it. I guess he's been on the phone with Nico, sent him this. But Bannon is awesome, great hire, patriot, a true nationalist who really understands the immigration issue. Not a shakeup, no one fired or is leaving, 100% additive, an addition that Manafort welcomed. I mean, he wants the help. And again, Stone writes for Breitbart. Kellyanne Conway has excellent and solid and awesome, and Trump listens to her. These are all anti-New World Order patriot globalists. It just shows who Trump is. The fact that he's been friends with Bannon for decades. See, I mean, Trump's a sleeper patriot. That's why they're so pissed. They've got a dossier on him. Washington Post, New York Times claim that it is a demotion for Manafort. It's BS being peddled by loser Corey Lewandowski, the architect of the Trump defeat in Wisconsin, North Dakota, and Colorado. New York Times attacks undermines Trump campaign manager. It is because the Mexican owner of the Times is the largest donor of the Clinton Foundation. The whole Russia, Putin, Trump, Manafort charge is Hillary is bogus. DNC leaks by... Crucifer 2 and WikiLeaks, not Russians. So that's his talking points to me. I've never found him to be inaccurate. That guy, I read quotes him in the 80s. He said, listen, my leaks are always good because you just might have a fake leak. You don't ever get to leak again. And so I'm going to just see if we can get Stone on, but there's just major shakeups. I want to go to Joe Biggs and others on the ground about to leave Wisconsin, covering 3 days of rioting and the media hyping it when there wasn't too much rioting the last few days. And, of course, the Trump rally last night. We've got some clips of that. But finishing up with Steve Quayle, who'll be in studio with us for 2 hours on Monday. Steve, I've never had a chance to meet you in person. Things have gotten so... I know your face hadn't hardly been seen in decades until the last year or two. And that's why you made these films. You've decided to go public despite security issues, I know, because I think you understand. I'm putting words in your mouth, but am I right? You know we're coming down to the wire, so you're doing your maximum effort.
Absolutely, Alex. So we are at the wire. I don't think it's a process anymore. I think it's a flashpoint now, okay? And so, again, I want to share with your audience, and I look forward to meeting you, and obviously, you know, being in studio with you and Gary. But also, I want to thank you for the team you've put together, because personally, I really like Joe Biggs. I don't know, you know, I don't know them personally, but I think I think you're hated by the mainstream because you have something that they lost a long time ago. That's called investigative journalism. And Alex, when I say that, it's a genuine compliment. People that know me accuse me of being blunt, unkind, unloving, but I don't kiss anybody's anything. But I believe the Bible is accurate when it says, give credit to whom credit is due, honor to whom honor is due. And look, here's the thing. When people, you know, say whatever they say to you about me or vice versa or this or that, I ask them, I said, who are you, you nameless, anonymous troll? What have you done? So I'm really excited, you know, and I think I've been interviewed by David, and I think I don't know that I've ever been interviewed by Jakari, but the bottom line is I'm excited because, look, just as, and I'm no Matt Drudge, but I want to shake your hand. And I'm not, you know, one of those guys that does something like this. If it weren't for our mutual friend Gary Haven, I would never probably come to your studio. And it's not because of you, it's just because of all the attendant security issues, you know. And obviously now that you know that's out there, you'll have to take some more precautions.
Don't worry, this place is an armed camp. Nobody knows where it is.
Yep. Good. But anyway, so, you know, I want to thank you. And again, Alex, I just got to tell you something. You know, there are millions of people who have gotten it. I'm getting emails from law enforcement in Canada and around the United States that say they listen. They're grateful. And
we're grateful to them. It's very, very humbling, but it's scary to be right in the eye of the storm. Well, I look forward
you want to be in the eye of the storm, okay? Because remember this, that's a good place to be because even Elijah the prophet was in the eye of the storm, and it didn't touch him, okay?
Absolutely. Well, stevequayle.com, we will talk to you next week. Very rare to have you live in studio anywhere. In fact, I don't think, how many decades has it been since you've been live in studio somewhere?
Well, I can say this, probably 25 years I haven't, so just in the last 6 months I have.
Yeah, it's exactly. It's unprecedented that at this time you are really getting even more physically active out there in the field. Steve, I can't wait to sit here with you in studio next week. God bless you, sir.
Thank you, Alex. God bless everybody.
Folks, things have escalated with Russia right now. I'm going to be shooting a special report right after the show. We're working on getting Stone. Can you come on at the start of the next hour? Yeah, he's been blowing my phone up, and then I got other people blowing my phone up. Talk about Twilight Zone. The phone call's coming into this phone. You can't make up. Everybody from Donald Trump to four-star generals to just you name it. It is a total insane asylum. And, you know, we're about to go to our reporters. I am so glad I'm not with all those timid souls that sell out. I don't want to be accepted by the establishment. I don't want to be on the big private jet. I want to defeat tyranny and stand up to scum. That's what I'm looking for. I want to see the light of liberty in everybody's eyes. I want to see racial tensions basically brought down to nothing. There'll always be some problems. And I just can't believe that there's so many weird little cowardly yes men and women out there who will play along with this system when you know this system's a fraud and is designed to rob you of your future. I'm going to go to the crew in about a minute. As soon as they're ready, I see they're getting their cameras set up. I will go to the crew. We got Joe Biggs right there. Find out which town he's in. They're in Wisconsin. They're going to be coming back soon. He's getting a lot of intel from Secret Service sources and Pentagon sources. And you have to understand, with the Secret Service, this is not people we know. But these are known Secret Service people. But then it's vetted through people Biggs does know in law enforcement and the military. And I've got to say this. I think there's already been a break with the globalists in CENTCOM and in SOUTHCOM and in special operations and in most of Homeland Security. I would say from, you know, the bottom to about 90% up in these organizations, people know what's going on. Then you've got globalist operatives above them. But what woke up the bottom of the pyramid is just how evil their bosses are. And when they, I mean, here's an example. When they called in, and we're going to go to Joe Biggs, when they called in Missouri and California and in Indiana in 2008, within 2 months of Obama being elected in 2009, they called him in and they said, we're going to have a war with gun owners and veterans and Christians and conservatives. We're going to ban their speech and we're going to basically put them in re-education camps. I've seen the videos. Some of these I've been shown and they're not allowed to put out. Other people come here, go, look at this, show me, and then go, you can't have it. Repeatedly. But I've also gotten the documents and some of the training videos you've seen. We broke them. Where people get up in the meeting and go, what the hell? George Washington's the enemy and we're going to arrest Christians? What the hell is this? And they're like, get out of here. You're going to be, I mean, this is going on, folks. And that was 8 years ago, 7.5 years ago. Can you imagine the crazy town stuff going on now? So we now go to Joe Biggs in Wisconsin to learn about the last 24 hours developments. Then we'll talk to Jakari Jackson. There's a lot of videos up on Infowars.com of weird, supporters of Hillary flipping out that, quote, white males would dare talk to them. I mean, a lot of craziness. Joe Biggs, thank you for joining us. Exactly where are you now?
We're actually right down the road from where the initial shooting, which led to the riots on a Saturday evening in Milwaukee. We're actually right off of 36th Avenue, and it's called Burley. So right behind me is a bank that was actually burnt down. But if you notice to the right, much like Ferguson, the police department is right beside it. Just like we saw in Ferguson where the riots took place, there was a police department and a fire station right across the street from the mini mall that was burnt and those businesses went down. There's a number of businesses all around here have been burnt. The Metro PCS was raided.
Why do you think the police stand down?
I don't think it's the police that stand down. I think it's someone gives the order, and if you break that order and then something happens, then you're held liable for it or accountable for it. So I think someone up top is giving an order, and the rest of the guys are just sitting in the office like, it's kind of like Benghazi. You know, these guys wanted to go out, and they're told to stand down, and then after so long, they say, screw it, we're going. You know, so I don't think the everyday cop is trying to just sit here and watch everything.
No, I get that. I'm saying, why do you think the stand down was given?
I don't know. I just don't get it. Maybe just to create more of a wound for people to see, for the media to publicize it and push it out, and other people are going to see it, and other people are going to get that anger. And what it is, it's a misrepresented anger that these young adults have that they don't understand how to deal with these situations.
Well, Sheriff Clark was spot really on. I mean, this is a cosmology, a mental illness given to them by the leftist media to divert them from all the problems of the ghetto.
Yeah, it's insanity, and it's going to get worse before it gets better. You know, Trump came out last night talking about these riots, you know, and how he's going to be the law and order candidate to really step in and squash a lot of this stuff, really help out the black community, the LGBT community, and bring together this unity we haven't seen in a long time. And that's some of the points he was hitting on last night. But what I do want to talk about mainly today is Hillary Clinton. Now, yesterday, there's a lot of footage, pictures circulating around where she's had to lean up against stools. And there was a huge hashtag that started last night that was trending on Twitter called Stools for Hillary. And today in Cleveland, I had some people on the ground at the event there. She had no stool. When she got out of the vehicle, they actually left her alone to try to walk on her own to get in there, kind of to try to prove a point that, hey, she's okay. But at the same time, all she does is speak for a few minutes. And meanwhile, her vice presidential pick, Tim Kaine, came out today and said this. Let me pull up the article right now.
No, he said white people need to be a minority to know what it's like, as if just being white inherently is bad.
Oh, Tim Kaine says the United States is far behind Muslim countries in treating women equally.
What? Wait a minute. Where did he say that?
Equally.
Treating women. Are you joking?
I'm negative. This is on Breitbart right now.
Oh, my God.
This is the most insane thing, and that's why I said the other day.
Guys, pull that up.
We can't focus.
Oh, my God, there it is. U.S. behind some Muslim countries in electing women. Oh, my God. So they don't cut their genitals off or put bags over their heads. What in the hell? And that Kaine guy acts like a total total fruit basket, man.
Jakari made a really good point earlier. He was like, the Clinton Foundation doesn't treat women equally at all. They're like the worst.
Oh, yeah, they've only got men and pay the men way more.
Bill calls them bimbos when they call them out on rape. You know, that's insane.
But that's okay because, you know, he's from the Dixiecrat and, you know, probably a Klan member, and I'm serious when I say that.
See, this is the thing. Hillary Clinton's health is failing fast. But
she has to sit on a damn chair. She can't even stand up.
No one, if Tim Kaine would have been the Democratic nominee against Trump, he would have never won. Hillary Clinton's a well-known person. She's been in politics her whole life. They have to hold her up long enough to get her in.
Now, that Kaine guy looks like the most. If that guy came to sell me stuff, I'd slam the door in his face. He looks like a criminal.
The establishment knows her health is going to fail, and she's not going to be able to carry this out. And the torch, the baton is going to be passed on to Kaine. So I think that's where our investigating needs to go from here on out. That's where our focus needs to be. Who is Tim Kaine? Why do the elite want him so bad? Why are they putting him in this position when they know Hillary Clinton's going to fail? Why do they need him? We know he's involved in a lot of crazy stuff, but what is it? He wants the TPP. He wants a lot of this stuff, but we need to look into this man. I think that's where our focus should be from here on out.
I agree. Speaking of Trump last night, at the rally, reaching out to black folks. Here is that clip. We'll go back to Joe Biggs and Jakari Jackson.
I'm asking for the vote of every African-American citizen struggling in our country today who wants a different and much better future. It's time for our society to address some honest and very, very difficult truths. The Democratic Party has failed and betrayed the African-American community. Democratic crime policies, education policies, and economic policies have produced only more crime, more broken homes, and more poverty. Thank you. We reject the bigotry of Hillary Clinton, which panders to and talks down to communities of color and sees them only as votes. That's all they care about, not as individual human beings worthy of a better future. They have taken advantage. She doesn't care at all about the hurting people of this country or the suffering she has caused them, and she, meaning she and her party officials, there has been tremendous suffering because of what they have brought. The African American community has been taken for granted for decades by the Democratic Party, and look how they're doing.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's time to break with the failures of the past.
Oh, that's good. Full clips up on Infowars.com. And it's true. Black unemployment's doubled under Obama. And the Democrats admit, we got them. We don't have to help them. And if you're going to have an economy where you're handing stuff out and helping people and crime's exploding in areas, you should be spending money in those areas to try to stop that from happening. Joe Biggs, I'm going to come back and finish up with Jakari, but other points.
Well, this is the thing. Look behind me. A bank that was burnt down. Over here, tons of stores. This is a direct reflection of what's going to happen under a Hillary Clinton presidency. More stores burnt. More cities in distress. We go all over the country, and we look at all these war-torn areas like Chirac. This is a Democratic-run area. Poverty-stricken. Tons of violent gangs.
Everywhere they run stuff,
death,
it's a hellhole.
Murder, burglaries, rape. I pulled up an app here that shows crime in this area. It's all child rape. 10 cases within a
block. By the way, tons of child rape again in Europe, and now they're not even calling them Muslims when they do it. But that's okay, because Kaine said that Muslims treat women better than we do. We're bad. Did you know you had guilt, Biggs? You and I are bad to women.
Yeah, apparently. You know, I go out, take them to dinner, and, you know, buy flowers and do all that.
Oh, no. But if the Muslims cutting their genitals off and chaining them up, that's okay. What kind of upside-down world does this bastard live in? Little smiley face.
And we had that couple in Texas who was pro-Sharia law that had slaves in their home.
They let UN Muslims that are part of the UN are allowed to have slaves. They have diplomatic immunity in New York. They actually have people in chains. They have maids that go around the house with a chain. Sorry, go ahead.
30,000 Muslims have already been brought in this year, most of which will be pro-Sharia. When you go to these different countries and you do these polls and you ask them, are you pro-Sharia? Yes. They say yes. They say yes. Ask them if they're pro-ISIS. Most of them say yes. In Paris, France, most of them support ISIS. and they want to bring those same people here.
That's right. 56% in France support ISIS. Something like 31% support suicide bombings. It's crazy. All right, Joe, great job. We're going to come back, finish up with Jakari Jackson, and then he's coming on with breaking news. Roger Stone. I'm going to go like 15 minutes in the next hour, then hand the baton to Paul Joseph Watson from London. This is true independent media worldwide. I'm not going to belabor this. Armageddon, the film, $5 million budget exposing the New World Order in a fiction form, is exclusively available at InfoWarsStore.com. If you get a second copy, you get two of my films free. The problem is we're selling out of all the DVDs we have. I mean, not of Armageddon, but of the other DVDs that are my films. So by next week, it's probably going to be, you know, you get a bottle of colloidal silver or something free when you do it. But I'm glad folks are getting that. But, I mean, we are the exclusive place to get it. Armageddon, and the purchase helps fund our operation. Then you can wake people up with the film, donate it to the local library, or give it to a school. After you watch it, it's a great way to spread the word. Right now, you get the Police State Trilogy and Police State 4. So that's actually not two films free with it. It's four films free. InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com. We have 20% off on the Parasite Cleanse Living Defense. All right, going to Jakari Jackson. Jakari, fabulous job with the videos you guys posted. A lot of bedlam, a lot of craziness, folks getting triggered, but I'm glad to see things stabilizing, winding down. The communists weren't too successful. Other observations, Jakari Jackson?
Yeah, as you guys were talking about, I want to dovetail really quick on Hillary Clinton. You guys were talking about the war on women and how, you know, the treatment of women here in the States. There's an article in Drudge right now from The Guardian talking about how women are growing in the prison populations. And that's nothing that's new. I remember back when I worked in the jail system back in 2012 in Oklahoma, we had a big female population, and it is a growing thing. And many of these people were non-violent drug offenders. So that's something I'd like to dovetail on. Now, speaking to the situation here in Milwaukee, we've seen a lot of reports, people saying that they were threatened. And I'm sure there were people who were threatened, but we've been out here for 3 days now. Nobody's threatened us. We felt very safe. But I will say that one thing that a lady told me a little bit ago, we were at the O'Reilly's auto parts store that got burned a few nights ago. And there's a lady, I think she worked at the facility, or she seemed to be very familiar with it. And she was saying, hey, you know, you guys are reporters, you might want to be out of this area before 7 o'clock. And I was like, well, why is that? She says they're not really friendly to people after 7 o'clock. Now, maybe she's seen things that I haven't.
Well, sure. Weren't reporters attacked like Monday night or something?
Yeah, there were some people who were, but you know, since we've been out here, it's been very peaceful, very calm, and there's a heavy police presence. I'm sure that lends to it as well. But different opinions from different people.
I mean, but imagine the Second Amendment. Imagine if that O'Reilly Auto Parts is your business, Jakari. You're going to be in there cleaning it up night or day. You're going to have a sidearm on your side. Somebody comes in and attacks you, that's their problem.
Yeah, I mean, and that's what the Second Amendment is for. They always will say it's about duck hunting, or they say it's to, you know, commit crimes. No, it's to make sure that you don't become a victim of a crime. And that's why you have a Second Amendment here in the United States of America.
Jakari, you've always got interesting perspectives. What do you make of Hillary? Do you agree she looks really sick, acting really weird? I mean, just the last few months and something strange is going on, or do you think maybe she's just getting old?
Her videos, when she goes out to speak, or, you know, she breaks down these coughing fits, she looks like she had a seizure. And that's not even, you know, speaking ill of the woman. She legitimately looks like she has some health problems. And when you look at somebody who's that ill, can they really stand the stress, the rigors of being a president when you're constantly criticized, you're constantly in the public eye? As Biggs was pointing out, she needs help getting out of her car, pillows for Hillary, all this other stuff. You know, she's coughing up a lung. The lady does not appear to be in good physical condition.
Well, great job to you and the whole crew. When are you coming back to Austin?
Tomorrow. So we'll be on the plane tomorrow, and we'll head back, and more special reports. We got some more stuff coming on from the Trump rally. Adu and Gabe, they're back at the hotel cutting up those videos right now.
All right, Jakari. And how do folks follow you on Twitter? How do they follow Joe Biggs?
Joe Biggs is at Rambo Biggs. I'm at Jakari Jax, J-A-K-A-R-I-J-A-X on Twitter.
In 50 seconds, I don't know if you've been busy, but on the road, have you seen the emails where Soros admittedly is running like the Islamic invasion and trying to shut down folks that criticize it? I mean, to me, that's bombshell. I mean, we knew that, but wow, this guy is something else.
Yeah, I've heard you talk about it, and it's not surprising. We see Soros with his hand in the cookie jar of many different things. So that's just another thing, whether it's civil unrest here or foreign conflicts. You know, the guy's always in on it. He's been on it, and he's going to keep doing it until he goes into the ground.
Yeah, you'd think at almost 90 years old, you'd be fishing or something.
Yeah, you know, go out fishing, go out hunting, you know, playing backgammon.
I'm 42 and I want to quit doing this. All right, Jakari, we'll see you back here in Austin. Those reports, great job. Fourth hour coming up with Paul Watson. First, Roger Stone's popping in with big breaking news. Stay with us. I only use this example because it's so bizarre to me. It just hits some weird spot in my brain that both my grandfathers came close to dying in World War II. They never wanted to talk about it. And then later after they died, we got into their army manuals and, you know, graduation yearbooks from the Army Air Corps and the rest of it. One was a fighter pilot. One of them was a B-17 pilot. And my dad's dad would always tell him, oh, I was just a cook. I didn't do anything. And then, of course, he did his 22 missions out of North Africa into Italy during some of the worst air fighting. And then he was somebody that ran things as a mid-level officer over supply. But I could see why he didn't want to talk about it, because after he'd flown his missions and then he volunteered for more and he got like sunstroke basically from not wearing sunglasses, burned his corneas. And then like a few missions later, everybody died and the plane blew up. You know, that was all in the literature and in the articles. And I'm just thinking about them flying missions over Italy and over Eastern Europe. And down below is 15-year-old George Soros rounding up Jews and persecuting them and finding where they're hidden and doing all this. And then it's weird. Like, here I am. My grandfathers are both dead. One of them almost died on a landing in the fighter plane flipping and almost killing him. And I'm sitting here. I'm having to fight the weird, almost 90-year-old, creepy Nazi collaborator. And then all these weird leftists are worshiping him and supporting him and love it and think it's cute and make excuses. And it's just so surreal. It's like, what type of world is this where generation after generation I'm fighting, my family's fighting the same creature? Because he was a small part of that then. But it's just, it's wild to know that. Roger Stone is popping in with us in this segment and the next. We're about to go to break, but Roger Stone, you say you've got major breaking news dealing with the shakeup in the campaign. Bannon, the head of Breitbart, has said that it's just an expansion of the campaign, but mainstream media says this is the campaign in disarray. What's really going on?
Yeah, no, that's a total mischaracterization. This is typical of the mainstream media's attempts to undermine the Trump campaign. Donald Trump has been running a campaign with a skeletal staff for some time. He has a good national political director, Jim Murphy, but he's totally immersed in building a national organization, particularly in the key states. He has an excellent press operation with Hope Hicks and Jason Miller. He has a campaign chairman and a campaign deputy. The Clinton machine has hundreds of people on the payroll. So this is two exceptionally talented people, Kellyanne Conway, who I think Donald and Ivanka have a great confidence in, who has a special expertise and knowledge about women voters, a friend of mine from lives in my native state of Connecticut, and Steve Bannon, who, like you and I, Alex, is a nationalist, who believes in national
sovereignty. And so patriots got added to the whole deal, and the media spins it into some type of defeat that he's adding some heavy hitters.
No, look, and there's no question that Bannon, like me, is an advocate for an outsider strategy. Trump needs to take on the two-party duopoly, including those at the Republican National
Committee.
So it's
accurate to say the brass knuckles are going on right now.
Well, I mean, in all honesty, a week ago, the Republican National Committee spokesman entertains a question from the press saying, are you cutting off the presidential candidate's financing and support? And instead of saying absolutely out of the question, he says that's a decision we'll make in October. That is treasonous. That's not the role of the Republican National.
And this is Donald Trump who's raising the money for these ungrateful little neocon bastards.
Well, this is what you get when you make peace with the rhinos. They undermine you. I happen to know a major, major Republican.
No honor among thieves. Stay there, Roger. We're going to give you the floor for one segment. I know you're busy. When we come back, get ready. Roger is hot. Stay with us. All right, Paul Watson is hosting right now, but I'm over into the fourth hour because Roger Stone's here with breaking news. Paul Watson, jump in anytime, who's about to be hosting the show in about 10 minutes, anytime you want. Roger Stone, former head of the Trump campaign, his former business partner, was the head of it, now still major part of it. But they brought in Bannon, the head of Breitbart, who's known as a real street fighter. And the word is that if you think Trump took the gloves off the last month, get ready for brass knuckles to be put onto those fists. So let's talk about what this really means, Roger Stone.
Alex, look, I think this is a giant plus for the Trump campaign. Steve Bannon is a street fighter. He is a nationalist. He understands the immigration issue particularly well. He is hardline anti-Islamic terrorists and radical Muslims. He is skeptical. He's not a neocon. He very much understands the globalists are the enemy here to democracy, to freedom. He's not a fan of George Soros, to say the least. So I share his worldview very much. He is also a very successful executive who really understands the new media, which is going to be important for Trump's candidacy. He's not replacing Paul Manafort. This isn't a shakeup. It's an expansion.
And he said that. He's augmenting things.
So you have the New York Times and the Washington Post, and most likely being propped up by Sidney Blumenthal and Corey Lewandowski, trying to write this as some kind of a shakeup when Trump expands his campaign with two more pros because many hands make work light. I mean, this is a presidential campaign.
Sure, Hillary has 500 people. Trump has 50. I'm getting on to Lewandowski for a minute because, I mean, obviously he's old news, but he really is out there tweeting against Manafort. He really is like a Benedict Arnold. I mean, maybe Trump should call
him. To go out and say, I only want what's best for Mr. Trump in the campaign. Attacking Trump's campaign manager is not helpful to the campaign. The guy's a lout. I mean, he just has no sense of...
This seemed to scare the mainstream media.
Some people are in this to elect Trump. Others are measuring the curtains for their next job. It's pathetic.
Exactly. So this is a big plus, though, having Bannon on board.
I think it's terrific. And Kellyanne is an experienced pro, and they work well with Manafort and his very skilled deputy, Rick Gates, a very capable guy who helps keep the trains on time. And I think they all have a good relationship with the Trump children, who are the greatest assets of this campaign. I mean, I don't know why the media is so fixed on the internal workings of our campaign. Could they just focus on the content of Trump's speeches? And the scrutiny, if they would put the Clinton Foundation and the Clinton Global Initiative scams, because they're slush funds for grifters. They're not legitimate charities. They're breaking more charity laws than you can imagine. They are vehicles for the facilitation of multi-million-dollar bribes from China, from Russia, from Saudi. But the New York Times isn't interested in that. Instead, they cook up a fabricated story and put it on page one about Paul Manafort's perfectly legal dealings in Ukraine where he ran a campaign. It never worked for the Ukrainian government. There is no investigation. He is not the subject of investigation. There is no evidence against him that's admissible in any court. There's no evidence that he took any $12 million in payments. This is a hit job.
It certainly
is.
It's
not incidental that the owner of the New York Times is the largest single donor, a Mexican citizen, against
And again, then they say we're against Mexicans. No, what is some Mexican kingpin, the richest guy in the world, arguably, connected to all this corruption, doing, owning the New York Times, writing all these hit pieces? I mean, if I own some giant newspaper in Mexico and I'm up here in Texas, the Mexicans would be like, shut up, gringo, and they should. It's like, what are you doing involved in our stuff?
I cannot tell you how many reporters in the mainstream media said they read the Times above the page one story, above the fold story, and said, this is a nothing burger. They covered themselves five times by saying Manafort, who's not the subject of the investigation, it was a total fabrication. So, meanwhile, the Times does not dig into the very serious ongoing crimes at the Clinton Foundation. I'm talking about things that have transpired since Peter Schweizer wrote his terrific book, Clinton Cash. So, ongoing criminal conspiracies.
I want to bring Paul Watson in, who's hosting this hour. Don't be timid, Paul. Come in here, and any comments or questions for Roger Stone? I've got a few more.
No, I think with the Bannon situation, Alex, there was a headline in Bloomberg Business Week back in October. This man is the most dangerous political operative in America. That was before he was even officially on board with the Trump campaign.
And you know this why? He's influential, he's smart, and he basically sounds like Alex Jones.
Well, that's why I had to send out on tweet a congratulations, Steve Bannon. However, you are the second most dangerous man in American politics.
Sorry, go ahead.
Bannon is a good friend of mine, and he was actually featured in last year's international best and worst dressed list as one of the worst dressed men in America.
Okay.
And he loved it because I explained, this is a guy who is so concerned about saving the country, so concerned about saving America, that he eats at his computer. This guy is a workaholic and a whirlwind of great ideas.
I know. I was emailing with him this morning.
Don't worry about worldly crap like that. Just get me a hamburger.
He was responding in real time. And I talked to somebody else in the office that was talking to him while he was real time while I'm talking to him on email.
Yeah, no, look, so the guy is he is a whiz, and he understands the new media. I am, by the way, Paul, a huge Paul Watson fan. I love your writing and some of the investigative stuff you do. It's terrific.
Well, absolutely.
Thanks, I appreciate it.
Other stuff on the radar, and then I know you're busy. I'm going to let you go, Roger, and I'm going to turn this over to Paul. What else is going on? I mean, obviously so much is happening. We've got on Fox News, political science professor who's been right about five or six elections, says 87%.
Let me say this. The Clintons' activities in Haiti post-earthquake are about to blow in a big way. This will reveal corruption that will be stunning to the American people.
Well, it's known they stole more than half the money for themselves, and then she gave 97% of the money that she gives the foundation to herself.
But let's remember, previously, their defense on all of this is, you have no proof.
So,
all I'm going to say is I think the Haiti scandal will blow sky high.
Good. And the next week?
Well, sometime in the very near future.
Okay, let's expand.
See, the great thing is the truth can't be suppressed anymore. I understand that in the 80s, the Clintons could lean on news organizations. I wrote a piece on voter rigging for The Hill, and The Hill has come under intense pressure from the censors, David Brock, the self-appointed censor who's operating illegally under his tax status.
Yeah, that's like coming under censorship from some serial killer or something.
Yeah, demanding that we not publish the writings of Roger Stone. Why? Why are you opposed? Well, let people decide for themselves. Let them read my
piece. Yeah, why are you banned on everything? Because you do link to Stanford Research saying it's rigged and CBS News saying it's rigged. They're pissed.
My piece is thoroughly footnoted. Let readers decide for themselves whether I'm full of bull or whether I make a good case. I'm telling you the machines can be rigged easily.
Well, they have been. It's admitted.
I'm telling you you can use a $15 advice you can get at Radio Shack or Best Buy to vote multiple times on these machines without detection.
Sure. Let me throw this at you because we're almost out of time.
And I'm telling that this, I actually think that that both parties have rigged the machines in major contests in the last several years.
Let me throw this curveball at you, Roger. We're almost out of time here. I want Paul to have one more question. The situation with Hillary's health, I mean, I don't just hype that she looks really sick because, oh, that'll get her out of the race. We've got videos and stuff where she has to be helped up now, not just the photo Drudge showed, but Secret Service holding her up, her having to sit on a chair, her toddling around. She's obviously degenerating quickly. And we can scroll through the article. Hillary stools, hashtag, a new article. Clinton using chairs as crutches in countless speeches. You scroll down, it shows the Secret Service having to hold her up. I mean, she looks like she's sitting on a toilet or something. Maybe she's changing her diaper. What's going on here?
I don't think that she is well. Remember, we have the sworn testimony of Huma Abedin saying she's easily confused. I don't think she's in good health. I don't know what the degenerative disease she has is. I've seen various physicians write their theories based on appearance and other symptoms, but none of them, of course, have examined them. She does not look well to me. Her whole campaign style is based around the fact that she has no stamina. This is why we have no press conference in 200.
But then she says it's kooky if we say she has no stamina. She has no stamina. She said last week she could barely get up. If she lays down, she can't get back up. But it's a total conspiracy theory that she has no stamina and that she's sleeping.
Well, I understand that. So one has to hope that in the campaign that the rigors of the campaign will demonstrate this more and more to the American voters. Beyond that, you know, I'm not. I understand the intricacy of losing sympathetic female voters if you raise this in the wrong way. But my guess is that the American people will catch on to this by in the next 90 days. We've already caught on to it. The non-elite media has already figured this out. It's only a matter of time before the voters figure it out.
Well, I'm glad that Trump is weighing in on this. Let's play that short clip and get a final question from Watson. And I'm going to hand the baton to Watson here with Roger Stone, who's got to go. Here's Trump a few days ago talking about Hillary. The big question is Umid Abedin actually the groom of the stool?
Hillary Clinton has supported tax increases on the middle class for her entire career. She's voted for higher taxes 235 times in the Senate. I thought it was more than that. That doesn't sound. Think of it. She's voted for tax increases. And by the way, she's proposing a big one today. In her speech, her teleprompter speech, she's got her speeches are so short, though. They don't last long. You know, they're like 10 minutes, let's get out of here. Go back home and go to sleep. 3 days later, she gets up and she does another one and goes back home and goes to sleep. Oh, boy, is ISIS hoping for her. Is China hoping? Can you imagine China? They come in. You ever negotiate with the Chinese? They're tough. They're tough. You got to hit them back with a lot of energy.
I just don't see her winning. In closing, I'm going to let you go. Roger, I appreciate your time. StoneZone.com. We have the Clinton rape shirt that you designed available exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com. That helps fund our operation and what you're doing. What do you make of USA Today app maker Trump will win, saying their people are way more Trump than Hillary? Political science professor, Trump is 87% winning. He's been right about at least five, maybe six elections. Social media partners, patterns show Trump is looking at landslide victory. I mean, I just see the grassroots, the crowds, the people. I just see this.
It's more evidence that these polls, like Reuters, are rigged to show her further ahead or ahead when she's not. There's clearly no energy surrounding her campaign. She's drawing tiny crowds. The media has to endeavor to shoot the event in a way to make it look like there's more people than there are. Trump is bringing record crowds everywhere he goes. At the end of the day, I still argue between a voter fraud, which is not non-existent, as the left says, but somewhat limited, you're still going to have efforts to vote many illegal immigrants in the machine-run Democratic states. And as I have posited, these machines are quite easy to rig. Indeed, there's evidence that they have been rigged before. This is why I'm organizing a project to do exit polls in Pennsylvania and probably Virginia.
Well, we're going to have you back up, but I got to say this. I got to interrupt. I got to interrupt since you said it. Reuters, U.S. offers states help to fight election hacking. That's Reuters with Jay Johnson. I thought Obama said 2 weeks ago or a week and a half ago he doesn't even know what election fraud is. Now suddenly they say it's a major issue. You were on here last week and or Monday. You said you were more worried about the federal elections people doing the hacking than anybody else, and now they're announcing it, Roger. Final comment.
Yeah, no, look, I think we know the rubric here and how this works. First, you set an expectation with the polls, and then between voter fraud and election theft, which are two completely different things. Voter fraud involves people voting multiple times, people who are not eligible to vote, voting, illegal immigrants voting, and machine manipulation. This election can be heisted. And there's several ways to combat that. Some third party, a truly independent party, should be allowed to look at the software for these machines on the eve of the election.
But Jay Johnson says he's going to hook up some special stuff to make sure it's all accurate.
Mm. Yeah, right. Look, when the president came out and said the idea of a voter fraud and election theft was ridiculous, that was the instant in which I knew they were going to try it.
In fact, we got to find the clip. You actually said, whether it was last week or Monday, when we brought this up, you said, watch out. They're going to send people. That's who you got to watch. And then sure enough, they're doing it.
Yeah, I think there's a number of ways to both discourage the theft of this election and to document it. This is not, as some on the left want to say, Trump positioning himself so that no matter the circumstances of his losing, if he loses, he can say that it was stolen. No, he has to have solid evidence that there is theft, evidence of voter fraud or evidence of machine manipulation. That can be collected, and I think to protect the security and honesty of this election, it's incumbent on Trump.
Well, we're
going to
do it together. And you're absolutely right. Look, they claimed he was being a sore loser when he was winning primaries and he was contesting it, but he won because he contested. Bernie didn't, he lost. So Michael Moore and Cuomo's son, they can all go to hell. StoneZone.com. Thank you so much, Roger.
Great to be with you.
There he goes. All right, Paul, sorry to cut into your time. I know you got a big guest coming up right after the break. But, Paul, epic times to be alive, my friend, from Her Britannic Majesty's London, England. I hand the baton to America's favorite redcoat, Paul Joseph Watson.
What an introduction, Alex. I don't know if I can live up to that introduction there, but I'll try. You were talking about the polls, and again, we had the article up today, I think it was out of Liberty Blitzkrieg. These polling organizations are left-wing. They're biased, most of them. There are a couple of notable exceptions, but we tried to do polls on different issues over the past few years. Some of these polling agencies refused to even take our money because we weren't aligned with them politically. That's how biased they are.
I forgot about that, because I used to do polls like 15 years ago, and they would try to screw you, but now they just go, no, we got to do that again.
Yeah.
We got to call up and record them doing it. Ought to go to New York with a hidden camera and show it.
It wasn't even about a conservative liberal issue. It was about the TSA, and this one left-wing polling organization said, no, we're not even going to take your money, which goes to the heart of it, which is their bias. So you look at Bloomberg, you look at Reuters, they ask people, who are you going to vote for? People say, I'm not going to vote for either Trump or Hillary.
They had to do
and
Hillary.
They refuse to take that as an answer. They say, no, you have to choose one. Are you going to vote for Hillary? It's going to be Hillary, isn't it? And
they
say, oh, okay.
Let's get ready to rumble. Sorry, go ahead. I'm out of here now, Paul. I'm going to stop playing Mr. Microphone here.
So they pressure them over and over again, even though they've told the polling agency they're not going to vote for either Trump or Clinton. They say, but what if you did vote? Would it be for Hillary? Would it be for Hillary? They eventually relent and say, yes, it would be for Hillary, even though they're not going to vote. They take all those answers and include them in favor of Hillary.
Paul, so you're like, not saying they ever rig anything, are you? I mean,
no, it's just an outrageous conspiracy theory. So Reuters had Trump marginally ahead. They included all the people who are not going to vote and said, oh, no, they're actually going to vote for Hillary, even though they said, I'm not going to vote. And that's how Hillary has the lead in these polls.
And that's just what they're telling us, bro.
Yeah. And then you've got the more accurate online polls, which show Trump is far, far closer to Hillary. And it's this whole social stigma thing. You know, Trump is literally Hitler all of a sudden. So people aren't going to say on the phone, yes, I'm going to vote for Trump. But it's like Brexit. All the polls for Brexit beforehand were wrong. They showed that the Remain vote was clearly ahead by 5-6 points.
Oh, yeah. I really hate the West, though.
The vote. They were all wrong. They were all completely wrong because people...
Paul, side issue. I'm going to let you take over, but I'm having too much fun. I'm up in the ante to get Aid Skrelix and Carl the Cuck. Now it's up to $20,000 apiece to come and appear on this show for at least 2 hours. I'm going to be nice to them, by the way. They don't know how nice we are behind the scenes. Can you imagine having dinner with Carl the Cuck? Oh, that'd be incredible.
If you could get Trigglypuff in there, then that'd be quite the event. But what was it, $5,000? I think you've got to go higher. But again, these people have been...
I'm offering them 20 apiece.
Their lives have been literally turned into memes.
I know, so they need to like own it and like make a little money off of it.
No, I mean...
You know what they say in Japan, you know...
Yeah, we created the legend. They should just embrace the legend of who they are and, you know, build a career out of it.
Yeah, I mean, you want to sit there and while you're white and yell, you're an effing white male. I hate the Western world. Yeah, I really hate it. Yeah, It's so oppressive. Oh, yeah. I wish my someplace wasn't like this.
It's an amazing achievement. In fact, Triggly Puff is almost at 1 million views on my YouTube channel, so people need to go back and watch that video because it's at like 900.
I'm going to be honest with you. Triggly Puff is unbelievably hot.
Unbelievably so. And in fact, you know, I've seen her on
Tinder. I love how she sits there
and
unscrews the little bottle she has to drink. Like, we shouldn't laugh. These are victims, buddy. That is mind control.
You should have seen the stuff that people who went to her college sent to me privately, stuff that's not even on the internet. It's even funnier than anything you've seen about her requirements for...
All right, I'm going to get out of here. All I'm going to say is, fire at will, Commander. Sorry to cut into your time today. Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock. Paul Watson with his guests coming up. Straight ahead from Her Britannic Majesty's Command Base there in the Atlantic Ocean, London, England. I'm Alex Jones, coming to you from a secret location.
We are back live. It's the Alex Jones Show, fourth hour overdrive, with me, your host, Paul Joseph Watson. Now, Drudge All Day has had the headline up as his top link, Pillows for Hillary. Again, everywhere that Hillary goes, every speech she gives, she needs to be literally propped up by pillows. If you saw the video yesterday, her visit to Joe Biden's house, literally struggling to even walk up the drive, holding on to railings, holding on to the table. This is a major issue. It's a major cover-up. The mainstream media is panicking about Hillary's health. And of course, for the past couple of weeks, they've relied on that old adage of this is just a conspiracy theory. Daily Beast, which of course is a Clinton mouthpiece, came out and attacked me, attacked Mike Cernovich, said, oh, you don't have any experts. You don't have any health professionals. Even though in my original video, which has now got 3 million views, I named all the neurologists, all the doctors, all the health experts that circulated these suspicions, these concerns in the first place. But they said no. Chris Hayes of MSNBC said no, this is just a nutty conspiracy theory. Well, now we've got Dr. Drew, who is known as America's most trusted physician, again, board-certified medicine specialist, an active physician, coming out and saying that he's gravely concerned about Hillary's health, coming out and saying that she has brain damage, that the drugs that she's being given are causing all these, quote, weird side effects. So again, that's not me saying it. That's not conspiracy theorists on the dark corners of the internet saying it. That's America's most trusted physician to add to the names of all the other health experts who have come out and said the same thing. This is not a conspiracy theory. We have noted professionals all saying the same thing, that there are major problems with Hillary's health, and the videos, the photos only continue to confirm that. So another individual who's been hot on the trail of this big controversy over the last few weeks is Mike Cernovich, author, writer, and social media pariah to the left. The book is Guerrilla Mindset. I have it right here. Mike, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
So, Mike, again, the media were obsessed with, you know, John McCain's health back in 2008. They forced him into releasing his medical records. This time around, they're attacking anyone who asks the same questions about Hillary, calling them conspiracy theorists. Why is being concerned about a presidential candidate's ill health only a baseless conspiracy theory when they're a Democrat? Explain that to me.
One of the people even sent me in a link where they were asking for Mitt Romney's health records too, including his psychiatric records. So it not only did the liberal media go after John McCain's records, they also went after Mitt Romney's records. Now, why are they doing this? Well, the DNC leaks proved it. It proved what you and I and others have said for years, people like Alex Jones, other pioneers have said for decades, which is the media takes its marching orders from the Democratic National Committee, and DNC leaks prove that.
I mean, literally, Daily Beast, they attacked me, they attacked you on the same day. They attacked you on a different issue, but this is a company that is owned by an organization whose board of directors includes Chelsea Clinton. It's literally a Clinton mouthpiece. And yet today, for example, they have the temerity to come out and say, oh, Donald Trump is hiring somebody who, you know, sits on the on this media organization that's been a mouthpiece for Trump since the beginning, when they're literally the same thing for Hillary Clinton. Now, Chris Matthews came out, I think it was last night, he questioned Hillary's health. The left went absolutely nuts. They tried to put him back in his box merely for raising the issue. We've got, you know, US News and World Report, CNN saying, oh, Hillary's physician a year ago told us that Hillary was completely fine. So, like, that's an impartial, independent source. And yet we've got all this new evidence that she's got major health problems. We've got Dr. Drew coming out today saying that he's gravely concerned about it. Again, hardly a right-wing extremist, Dr. Drew. Now, you started the trend last night on Twitter. Hillary's stools. Tell us about that.
Yeah, big picture is we have the media shook because we create news cycles. If we want something to be news, the media, they try to ignore it. They can't ignore it anymore. And that's why they're trying to dismiss us as conspiracy theorists, because they won't debate us. I heard Alex Jones even saying earlier in the segment, I'm offering these people $20,000 to come onto my show for 2 hours, $10,000 an hour. Man, I do okay in life. I wish I was getting $10,000 an hour to come on somebody's show. And they won't debate us because they know that the truth is on our side. So what we did with Hillary Stools was a reader pointed out to me, she said, I went to this rally and I noticed that Hillary was always leaning back on the stool, and she sent me pictures. And then suddenly I was like, holy shit. And I tweeted it out. People said, yeah, everywhere she goes now, there's a stool that she has to lean on, a leaning stool. So we held a live Periscope session. 15,000 people showed up and we came up with the hashtag Hillary Stools, which ended up being the number one trending hashtag on Twitter before the night was over.
Again, a testament to the power of just you as an independent reporter on this, taking that issue, turning it into a viral hashtag within a matter of minutes. And the other aspect of that, of course, which proves your point, is this weird handler, this black guy who initially was her medical assistant, then the media claimed he was a Secret Service agent. We drew attention to that, to the fact that he was, you know, basically hypnotizing her on stage when she had these freakouts after being confronted. He seems to have mysteriously disappeared, correct?
Yeah, and the stools have disappeared too. And the PSYOPs campaign, I'm very overt about what I do. I'm running a PSYOPs campaign. We're making it now so Hillary can't have her little precious stool to lean on. She's not traveling with her hypnotist. That is going to lead to fatigue. So we can expect more unforced errors from Hillary. Now, the mainstream media's freak out to this is evidence that we're on to something. They all know that Hillary's sick because they travel with her. They're on the airplanes with her. They're with her every day. That's why they're freaking out. That's why, again, the Daily Beast, they did a hit job on you. They did a hit job on me to try to get me banned from TV, bringing up out-of-context tweets from 5 years ago. That's how desperate they are. That's all they can do. They can't address our arguments, so they try to discredit us, but it doesn't matter. We're winning. We're getting our information out. It truly is an information war. And finally, for the first time in a very long time, people like us are winning.
No, I mean, you're trailblazing on this issue, and that's very apparent. What I've been told privately is that, you know, we had people out there ready today to get the footage from relatively close up of her getting out of the vehicle. Because, of course, we were told by a Secret Service source that they've spent around $500,000 on these three SUVs to lower the floor to provide some kind of disabled access. So we were going to get pretty close, get some photos, get some videos of that today. They changed the route in which Hillary arrived to whatever location she's at today to avoid media attention. So as he said, with the stool, they've taken away the stool, the weird handler who had the injection syringe, who calmed her on stage, he's disappeared. So while we have the Clinton campaign, and in fact, they came out yesterday to the Washington Post and said, this is a debunked conspiracy theory. How dare Donald Trump glom onto this? This is right-wing conspiracy theory. Well, if it's a conspiracy theory, why are you changing your behavior? Why have you removed the stool? Why have you removed the handler? They're obviously really sensitive to this, Mike, which suggests that there is some kind of cover-up going on. Do you think that they'll be forced at some point to release some kind of medical record to try and dismiss this whole thing.
Right now, they're trying to figure out a way to spin it. And I think they'll try to make a sympathy play. And they'll say, oh, Hillary did have some kind of health problems. And now these people are right-wing bullies. Can you believe? So what we'll do is we'll go from conspiracy theorists to they'll call us bullies next and try to make her, like the left always does, appear like a victim. However, that has perils and pitfalls because, as I'm fond of saying, pity doesn't get you votes and pity doesn't get you, you know, laid either. So just because people feel sorry for you and feel like you're being bullied, that doesn't mean that they're actually going to vote for us. So again, the media is so shook by this because they know that we're right. They're covering things up. A good example of that was, remember the Hillary, you know, the seizure thing? Well, an AP journalist said, oh, I was there and I didn't think anything was unusual. But I think it was either you or Stefan Molyneux posted the image of as it happened that that same so-called journalist was like this. What? She completely freaked out, right?
Completely, yeah. She came out and said, oh, it was nothing out of the ordinary that Hillary had this seizure that went on for like a minute. And then the mainstream media, MSNBC, came out and said, oh, I slowed down the footage. I edited the footage to make it appear worse than it was. They said this as they personally sped up the footage to try and get it over as quickly as possible because this weird bobblehead thing that she was doing went on forever. And as he said, this AP journalist came out, who was, you know, obviously pro-Clinton, said, oh, there was nothing abnormal about this exchange whatsoever. Look at her face. Tell me that that's not abnormal. Absolutely bizarre. But now we've got Dr. Drew coming out today. Again, they've tried to pin this on right-wing extremist conspiracy theorists. We've got Dr. Drew, America's most trusted physician. He said that he's analyzed the records that have already been released on Hillary Clinton. And even what they've released is very suspicious because she's getting treatment straight out of the 1950s, the 1960s. He said that he's gravely concerned about it because the very side effects that we've seen in all this video footage and in these photos, the weird seizures, the dizziness, the confusion, they're side effects of the medication that's inaccurately being prescribed to her by her doctors. So, you know, they can no longer just dismiss this by claiming it's Paul Joseph Watson, Mike Cernovich, when we've got more and more prominent voices coming out. And I guess you've also been contacted, Mike, by health experts, by neurologists like I have, who are saying the same thing, correct?
Yes, and I've also been contacted by Secret Service agents, as you have, and I've heard similar things that it is an open secret among the Secret Service agents that Hillary could fall down any time. And that's why if you look at the other picture of Hillary being held up by a Secret Service agent, there's another one depicted where he's sort of leaning over. They've actually been trained and undergone drills about Hillary's health now because they know that she could fall down or collapse at any time. And that was the interesting thing was I didn't know that you were on the see exactly. And you can see the one guy's holding her up and the other guy has his hands outreached. It also appears in his left hand he might be holding something. I don't know if he has some kind of pen, the tan jacket in his left hand, or which would be on the far right of us. He might even be holding something right there in his hand. We can't tell, though, for sure. And
Mike, on the other photos of this, you see, because people look at this and they say, oh, she must be on a tiny platform that's rickety and small. You see the zoomed-out photos, and it's this huge, wide platform. It's not even very tall. She wouldn't fall off it if she had adequate balance, right?
Right. That's how bad her balance is. And again, that's why she could fall at any time. That's why that stool is with her all the time now. Because, well, it isn't now because of us, thankfully. She knows at any time she can lean up against it, and we got it. We got her. Like, it's checkmated. Her health is a major issue. She could collapse at any moment. The media has always known it, and they've covered it up, but they can't cover it up anymore.
And you've got these three presidential debates coming up next month with Trump. Again, is she going to have this stool on standby? She's going to have to be walking around. This is the whole point of a debate. You have to project. You have to case your territory. It's like a dominant turf war kind of thing. merely with your, you know, your body language in these debates, she's going to be up there for a couple of hours of time with Trump at least, facing all these questions, which we know stresses her out. Do you foresee some kind of weird seizure or collapse in these high-pressure situations that are coming up for Hillary Clinton?
It was initially leaked to me by her own people that Hillary was going to push to have the debate sitting down, actually. So we exposed that right away. Hillary doesn't want to do the standing debate. So what I predict is that she is going to put up a bunch of barriers to try to make debates not even happen, because she wants them sitting down. As you said, she can't stand up for 2 hours. She doesn't have the health to stand up for 2 hours. She wants to have the debate sitting. So what I predict will happen is there's going to be a push to have the debate sitting. And if Trump won't do him sitting, which he absolutely should not do, then she's going to try to find a way to weasel out of the debates.
Amazing. Now, just in the final couple of minutes, Mike, tell people how they can find you on Twitter. Tell them about your website and where they can get the book.
Sure. My Twitter is my last name, which is C-E-R-N-O-V-I-C-H. And that sends you to my books, my website. DangerInPlays.com is my website, and I cover a lot of issues about life primarily. And I always try to make it positive. You know, you never want to give in to the enemy and to feel hopelessness and to feel despair. We always keep it positive. I also have a podcast on iTunes. My books are over on Amazon and Audible. So if you find my Twitter or you get a, or you go to DangerInPlays.com, that'll launch you to everything else I have going on.
Okay, that's dangerandplay.com, and the book is Guerrilla Mindset, which I got about a month ago and read it. I urge everybody to get that book. Mike Cernovich, we'll have you back on as this develops. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for your work, Paul. Kill it.
There goes Mike Cernovich again. Follow him on Twitter. The website is dangerandplay.com. Analyzing, tracking this Hillary's health scandal. Again, Drudge Report had the headline up earlier today. She's basically propped up by pillows at every speech she gives. We had the video yesterday where she visited, I think it was Joe Biden's childhood home. She literally needs a Zimmer frame at this point. I mean, not to be rude about it, but she looks like an 85-year-old granny who has problems getting from A to B, if A to B are 10 yards apart, which is exactly what the Secret Service agents have said privately. What the NYPD officers have said who work security at her events, she gives a 15-minute speech. She's literally collapsing. They have to help her back into the vehicle. This is obviously a major problem, given that she's about to take on, if she wins, the most stressful job in the world. And if it was all an open book and that these problems were known and we could discuss them and debate them, then fair enough. But it's a cover-up. They said, oh, her physician said a year ago she was fine, and we're supposed to swallow that and accept it and not question it. Every single leftist mainstream media outlet, from CNN to the Washington Post to MSNBC, has been in full lockstep cover-up mode, trying to dismiss these questions as conspiracy theories, even as more and more prominent voices come out and voice them. We're going to be back with the final segment of the Alex Jones Show after the break. Infowars.com. We'll be back. We are back for the final segment of the Alex Jones Show. Before we go to some final news headlines, InfowarsLife.com has Living Defense 20% off for a limited time. Again, 20% discount on Living Defense, the harmful organism cleanser. Now is the time to secure your bottle for this discounted price before we completely run out again. Again, start eliminating toxic and harmful organisms from your body naturally without harmful chemicals. Get the products. It allows us to send reporters out to Milwaukee, to the RNC, to the DNC, to all these Trump rallies, and actually challenge the mainstream media directly to get the truth out, to birth the legend of Carl the Cook and AIDS Skrillex and Trigglypuff. There's no more important cause than that. And it's all supported by you getting the products at InfowarsLife.com. Living Defense, 20% off for a limited time only. You've heard Alex rave about it. And again, it supports the growth of this platform, taking on the establishment media directly, which is exactly what we've done with Hillary's health. And Drudge Report now has my article from earlier linked. Again, Dr. Drew, who they call America's most trusted physician, a practicing physician, a board-certified medicine expert, not a conspiracy theorist. Remember, MSNBC had Charlie Pierce on there to debunk me. He was their noted medical expert, Charlie Pierce. Who's Charlie Pierce? He's a game show panelist, okay? That's their medical expert. We've got neurologists. We've got America's most trusted physician. We've got Secret Service people who have been around Hillary, NYPD officers who have been around Hillary. But where the conspiracy theorists for saying that there's something seriously wrong with Hillary's health? And they've been forced to address it. This is up on Infowars.com. Clinton campaign, Trump is parroting lies and deranged conspiracy theories about Hillary's health. So they came out and said that it was deranged. There was no evidence for it. And now Trump's glommed onto it, and he's just parroting conspiracy theorists like top neurologist, America's most trusted physician. Again, Secret Service agent whistleblowers who are saying, all saying the same thing as each other. They're all conspiracy theorists. Don't listen to them as Hillary stumbles around, holds onto railings, leans against a stool, is propped up by pillows, has coughing fits, has weird seizures. It's all conspiracy theory. Don't talk about it. You're a misogynist. You're a sexist. Hillary has a vagina. That's why she should be elected president of the United States. That's all they've got at this point. Let's hit some final news stories. Malmo enjoys its eighth night in a row of cultural enrichment. They've had eight nights in a row of cars being set ablaze in Sweden's third largest city again. They're all in the no-go Muslim ghetto areas, which the left says don't exist, as the police, as the firefighters, as the ambulance workers are afraid to even go there, as the taxi drivers are afraid to even take you there, as we're chased out of them by actual Islamists, like you saw in Molenbeek, Brussels. But again, they don't exist, as cars are set ablaze for an eighth night in a row in Malmo. None of it exists. It's a conspiracy theory. Norwegian police chief says xenophobia is highly rational and justified, cites crime stats. Again, those annoying racist facts are getting in the way of the left's narrative again. They blamed all these rapes that were taking place in Norway on Norwegian drinking culture. Again, nothing to do with the fact that they've imported thousands of migrants who have no respect for women, who literally have a game called Taha Rush, which is about raping women. But again, none of that exists. It's a conspiracy theory. Left campaigns to shut down migrant skeptic newspapers. Here in the UK, they're actually trying to make advertisers boycott newspapers that report the truth about migrant crimes to try and get them shut down. While leftists in Germany who work in refugee camps are actually being raped by migrants. That's going to wrap it up for the Alex Jones Show. We'll be back tomorrow. Breaking news at InfoWars.